Friday, June 17th, 2016 edition of The Alex Jones Show. I'm Paul Joseph Watson. I'll be sitting in for Alex for the first half of this broadcast. Then David Knight will be coming in with his take, his perspective on current events. Alex will be joining us. He'll be filing some special reports, so be sure to stay tuned for that coming up later in the show. As far as the news is concerned, well, it's obviously hot right now. The top of Drudge Report, Obama imports 1 million Muslims during presidency. He's also linked up there my story from a few days ago. Islamic speaker admits killing gays, belief held by moderate believers. And of course, this has been a massive argument in the aftermath of the Orlando shootings, the fact that the left has abandoned, has betrayed the gay community in favor of being politically correct, in favor of appeasing Muslims. They care more about protecting the feelings of Muslims than they do protecting the lives of gay people. So now on the other side of the Atlantic, which we're going to get to as well, we've got David Cameron's Reichstag fire event basically happened yesterday with the Brexit vote, the vote for the United Kingdom to leave the European Union. Of course, over the past 2 weeks or so, the vote leave camp has been pulling ahead in the polls, having been behind all along, because immigration was put at the top of the agenda. The vote leave campaign finally realized that this is the issue that British people care about. It got put to the top of the agenda. The polls start to swing the other way. And what happens? We have a mentally ill person murder a Labour MP on the streets of Britain, and they wasted absolutely no time whatsoever in hijacking this, in exploiting this. Before this mother of two was even dead, while she was still in the hospital, they were using this to demonize the pro-Brexit camp. Absolutely shameful from Labour, from the political establishment, from the mainstream media. We're going to get into that. We've got Joy Behar from The View, which is a show watched by, you know, 3 million people every day. It's quite important, reaches a wide number of individuals, saying that Donald Trump is, quote, working with ISIS to kill us. That's her nuanced and cogent analysis of the Colorado gay nightclub massacre. But she's got an ally in the form of former CIA head Leon Panetta, who said that Trump is, quote, aiding and abetting terrorists by simply pointing out that the US contrived, they helped build up, they helped create ISIS in their bid to topple Bashar al-Assad. So you've got the most ridiculous, absurd comments from someone like Joy Behar on The View being mirrored by the former CIA head, Leon Panetta. We're going to get to some of those clips after the break. State Department officials, dozens of them, are once again lobbying for US military action in Syria, but not against ISIS, against the government of Bashar al-Assad that is fighting ISIS. So they're still trying to get that act of regime change through, even though arming the jihadist rebels in the first place was exactly what led to the rise of ISIS, to San Bernardino, to the attack in Colorado on Saturday night. So we're going to get into all that and more. We've got Washington Post reporting 6 in 10 of you will share this link without reading it. They've done a study where 6 in 10 links that are shared on the internet are not actually read by the people sharing them, which again goes right to the heart of the left and virtue signaling and how they create, how they contrive this phony narrative based on virtue signaling, based on artificial promotion of narratives that are completely untrue. So we're going to get into all that and more after the break. This is The Alex Jones Show Live, breaking news at Infowars.com. Don't go away. We'll be right back. We are back live. It's The Alex Jones Show. Now, if you want to see one of the most moronic YouTube clips of 2016 so far, and let's be honest, it's got some pretty stiff competition. This was on The View, I believe, yesterday morning. It's The View's Joy Behar. And again, bear in mind, this show gets 3 million viewers every day. That's no small fry. They've got a very large audience of very impressionable people who are also quite stupid. So she gets up there and responds to Donald Trump's comments about the gay nightclub massacre in Colorado by saying that Donald Trump is, quote, working with ISIS to kill us. Let's start this clip.
They also don't have any ties right now between the shooter and ISIS at all. They think he, you know, at best,
except for one phone call, which everybody reminds me.
Okay, hit pause. So that's one of the other guests on the show saying that Omar Mateen, the Pulse nightclub gunman, had no ties whatsoever to ISIS. He only called cops during the massacre to pledge allegiance to ISIS. He only pledged allegiance to ISIS on Facebook during the massacre. And the Islamic State also claimed responsibility for the attack. But again, nothing to do with ISIS. Okay, let's carry on with the clip.
He mentions ISIS, but that doesn't make him tied to ISIS.
I agree.
So
he mentioned a whole lot of folks. Yes. He said he was aligned with a whole lot of folks. Listen, nobody's going to know what the answer is. Okay.
The thing about Trump, though, is that he's the recruiter in chief. He is
for ISIS.
He is basically working with ISIS to kill us. They are working together.
Yes.
Just remember what I'm saying.
And why do you say this, Troy?
Because every time you go after the Muslims and you talk about how they shouldn't come into the country and how they're all a bunch of whatevers, you are saying to ISIS, make another video to show people who are sympathetic to your cause. And
don't think pause. So she's making the argument that Donald Trump is working with ISIS to kill us. Those are her exact words, because he dares to point out that we have a problem with Islamic terrorism. You know, that's like the equivalent of saying, don't draw cartoons of Muhammad because it might trigger, it might upset the precious Muslims and they might kill us. They might chop off our heads. So we better respect their feelings. Again, completely insane. And it gets even worse. Let's carry on.
I haven't made many videos showing Donald Trump. He is a dangerous menace to the country. And I believe, and another point, one small point about the guns. To me, I wake up in the morning, I'm so stressed out because people are actually continuing to say, have more guns. Since 2005, half of all mass killings have occurred in this country. In 2005 is when
FBI statistics, every crime statistic you want to look at, mass shootings are down. Not that this has much to do with mass shootings, it has everything to do with radical Islamic terrorism. Continue with the clip.
Ban was lifted during the Bush administration, That is when half of all mass killings started in 2005 since the ban was lifted. So ipso facto, there is a connection to the guns.
Can I also say that I think it's very interesting. It's interesting to me that it's very telling that the first thing they notice about the shooter is that, you know, that he's Muslim.
So she's complaining that the first thing anybody noticed about the shooter was that he was Muslim. And in the background, you hear one of the other guests, I think it's actually Joy Behar herself, say that that's a racial thing to say. First of all, Islam is not a race. May I remind you of that fact? Second of all, of course, we're going to draw attention to the fact that he's Muslim. You had ISIS in their own publications calling for people to hit soft targets, calling for people to carry out stabbings, calling for people to carry out mass shootings, specifically during the month of Ramadan. But again, nothing to do with Islam. So of course, people are going to draw attention to the fact that he's a Muslim. A matter of, you know, 6 months ago or less, we had San Bernardino, another Islamic terror attack. These things are getting worse because ISIS is calling for them. The shooter pledged allegiance to ISIS. He was a devout Muslim. He used to get angry. He used to get triggered and threatened to kill people at barbecues because a bit of their pork touched his hamburger. I mean, this guy was completely crazy. He was a registered Democrat. You know, he was motivated by a hateful ideology defended and supported by the left, Islam. So obviously, we're going to talk about it. We're going to draw attention to it. Let's carry on with the clip.
Very telling to see the assumptions that are made. Hate is hate. We all know it. But It is hard. You have never heard of a mass strangling anywhere you go.
No, that's right. To the gunpoint.
You don't see mass. Yeah. You don't see mass stabbings where someone just went crazy with a.
Multiple times a year in China, where guns are more restricted, they have mass stabbings. A major one carried out in 2014, which killed 29 people. In the vast majority of those cases, stabbings are carried out by radical Muslims. So yes, we do have mass stabbings carried out in pursuit of the same cause. Again, total nonsense. Let's carry on with the clip.
And people waited in line to get stabbed.
One guy killed 50 people. How did he do that?
Exactly.
With that rifle.
And I think it's interesting for me, being a brown person in the United States, I will tell you, past year or so, since someone announced their candidacy, I was actually now seen as a non-American.
Mm-hmm.
And that is very hard for me in my day-to-day life sometimes when people see that. That's when you know that something's wrong.
Somebody was mean to her, and she doesn't even provide the specific example of what happened, and she blames it on Donald Trump. The fact that somebody made a racist comment to her over the past, 8-10 months since Trump announced his candidacy, that's Donald Trump's fault. Everything is Trump's fault. The violence aimed at Donald Trump supporters at rallies across the country is Donald Trump's fault. The Colorado shooter, a registered Democrat, a devout Muslim, somebody motivated by a hateful ideology defended and supported by the left. Must be Donald Trump's fault. Total, absolute nonsense from beginning to end. Total lies. But it's not just The View that's coming out with this. This is up on Infowars.com right now. Former CIA head. Trump is, quote, aiding and abetting terrorists. The former director of the CIA, Leon Panetta, has said that GOP nominee Donald Trump is effectively helping the enemies of America with divisive rhetoric. Again, whenever you see them use this term, divisive rhetoric, that means anyone who is standing up for principles. Anyone. They call it divisive. Total, total fraud. Appearing on MSNBC, Panetta, CIA head under Obama from 2009 to 2011, said, quote, in 50 years in public life, I have never experienced a major party candidate making the accusations and raising the innuendos that Donald Trump raised, particularly at this moment of crisis. Bearing in mind that Trump basically predicted what would happen in Paris. He predicted what would happen in Brussels. He's been dead on all along. You can argue about his methods for dealing with it. But again, raising innuendos by simply talking about Islamic terrorism. This is the most shocking thing that Panetta has heard in 50 years of public life. Totally overblown. Total hyperbole. He goes on to say, quote, he's not only accusing the president of the United States of treason and collaborating with the enemy, but in many ways what he's saying about restricting Muslims from coming into this country, doing surveillance on Muslim mosques, is basically aiding and abetting the enemy at a time we ought to be unifying. And he goes on to criticize Trump because Trump came out with this tweet in which he said that he posted a link to a Breitbart story, which is that Hillary Clinton had the memo that Obama admin aided group that became ISIS. This is a story we posted up on Infowars.com yesterday, detailing, which we've documented for years, that when the Obama administration went into Syria, went into Libya to arm, to fund those jihadist groups, al-Nusra, who later went on to defect, to join, to pledge allegiance to ISIS, that's what helped ISIS grow in the first place. When we say the US government contrived, created ISIS, we don't mean out of thin air. They already took the jihadist rebel groups, the extremists that were in that region, gave them weapons, gave them funding. They rebranded and everybody pledged allegiance to them. So yes, Clinton and Obama are directly responsible for ISIS's spread across the Middle East. And that's precisely what Trump is referring to when he links to this Breitbart article, which details this secret memo. And this is the article. The Obama administration supported the terrorist group that became ISIS as the group struggled to gain control of the Syria-Iraq border, where ISIS now claims its caliphate, according to an intelligence report sent to Hillary Clinton. Breitbart News reported Tuesday on a secret classified intelligence report sent to then Secretary of State Clinton and other top U.S. officials in August 2012. The report confirmed that Western and Gulf states are joining with Turkey, who still gives medical aid, gives weapons to ISIS in that same area, joining with Turkey, again, to support ISIS, to support the opposition to Bashar al-Assad. Instrumental in the rise of ISIS. Documented fact. So no matter how much, you know, Panetta blusters about how shocked he is that Trump would even dare make reference to this and that it's the most outrageous thing he's heard in 50 years of public life, the facts are the facts are the facts. You can't get away from that. We had the CFR 3 years ago saying, oh, we should go ahead and join with Al-Qaeda. Let's become their ally because toppling Bashar al-Assad is what's important. It led to the rise of ISIS. It was a disastrous policy, and Trump is perfectly correct to call it out. We'll be back with more in the next segment as the Alex Jones Show Live. Alex Jones is going to be popping in with a special report in the next segment about media deception surrounding Donald Trump, which is exactly what I was talking about before the break. Now, Leon Panetta, the former CIA head, is triggered, is shocked by the fact that Trump is daring to draw attention to the fact that the US government aided the rise of ISIS by arming, by funding jihadist groups in the Middle East that went on to become the Islamic State. We know this to be a fact. So for him to get out there and bluster and pretend that it's some shocking revelation, some insult to reality, is completely bizarre. And on that very subject, we've got this article out of RT. Hawks rising, dozens of State Department officials call for US strikes against Assad in Syria, because the destabilization of Syria over the past 4 or 5 years has not proved disastrous enough, right? We've got the biggest terrorist group, the biggest threat probably ever, spreading across the Middle East. We've got ISIS-inspired extremists carrying out attacks in the United States. No, that's not enough. Let's destabilize things even more by overthrowing secular governments, by leaving a vacuum for these extremists to come in and to take power. Bucking current US policy, dozens of State Department officials have reportedly signed an internal document calling for military action and regime change in Syria, claiming it's the only way to defeat Islamic State and end the war. So the only way to defeat Islamic State is to remove the government and the military that is fighting the Islamic State. Okay, that doesn't really make sense to me. The dissenting document was transmitted internally and signed by about 50 mid to high level department officials. According to the Associated Press, the agency said it has since been classified. This is a quote. The moral rationale for taking steps to end the deaths and suffering in Syria after 5 years of brutal war is evident and unquestionable. The New York Times quoted the document as saying the status quo in Syria will continue to present increasingly dire, if not disastrous, humanitarian, diplomatic and terrorism-related challenges. So, again, removing the government, the military from power, that is the primary fighting force in Syria against ISIS. That's how they're going to defeat ISIS. Yeah, you're going to have to run that one by me again because I'm not quite computing it. But remember, you know, last year Obama put out this order where he said any military target in Syria is a legitimate target. So basically they could bomb the presidential palace and say it was just part of anti-ISIS operations. Because the agenda all along has not been to take out ISIS. That's why they didn't bomb the oil fields. That's why they're doing nothing about Turkey continuing to fund to allow free passage to give medical care to ISIS fighters. That's why they still refuse to even talk to Russia, basically, during that whole bombardment where Russia had them on the run. So they're following the same insane, disastrous policy. Again, there's such opposition to it within the military, thankfully. We saw the big protest back a few years ago. You know, not in my name, the people holding up the signs, the active duty service members. I will not be Al-Qaeda's Air Force. So there's a huge element within the military which knows what this is about. They know it's not about fighting ISIS. They know it's about regime change. It's about toppling a secular leader that is against ISIS, that is against radical Sunni Islam. just as Gaddafi was in Libya, you know, the most prosperous country in Africa at the time, a decent place to go and visit if you were a tourist, secular government. He had the radical Islamists on the run. They took him out. And look what happened. It led to the biggest migration crisis in the history of the world and all the disastrous consequences that that brings with it. So now they're going to try and double down and do the same thing in Syria. Absolutely disastrous policy, but they're still intent on following it. Now, Hillary Clinton wasted little time in raising money off the Orlando terrorist attack. This is out of the American Mirror. No tragic event, not even an Islamic terrorist attack killing 49 people on US soil, is off limits from Hillary's grubbing for money, which is no surprise given that it's now been revealed 20% of her entire campaign has been funded by Saudi Arabia. Okay, so this is the big feminist candidate. Now, who was it? Oprah the other day came out and said, we need Hillary because she's a woman. She's got a vagina. That's the only thing she's got going for her. Okay, so she's this great feminist candidate. Fine. Then why is her campaign 20% funded by a government, by a regime that doesn't even allow women to drive, that still allows women to be stoned to death, that still allows gay people to be killed? Not really very progressive, is it? So this idea that she's this big feminist candidate when she's being funded by the most misogynistic regime on earth is completely laughable. We'll be back with more after the break. This is The Alex Jones Show Live, InfoWars.
On the march.
Reporting on this live Friday worldwide broadcast. We're about to throw it back here in about 4 or 5 minutes to Paul Joseph Watson and David Knight. Paul reporting from London, England. David Knight reporting from Austin, Texas. There are a lot of big developments obviously taking place in the world right now. I want to address a few of them. But number one, I want to discuss disinformation. There's a lot of different forms of disinformation. Lies, obviously, are one type of them. But it's worse than that. We see the mainstream media and its different minions, like Joy Behar of The View, and the former CIA director, Mr. Panetta, and others, Leon Panetta, coming out in a unified theme today, saying that Donald Trump is the biggest recruiter of ISIS and that he's, quote, working with ISIS and making ISIS attack us because he's saying we should defeat ISIS. He's saying we should control our borders and vet these people before we let them come in. That is saying that 2 + 2 = 4 is basically racist. And that's what Joy Behar also said, was that he was racist. Now, we're going to play some of these clips coming up here in a moment. Paul's going to get to it. He's obviously already been talking about it. But think about this. Think about the magnitude of this garbage that we're dealing with, that she's saying he's the reason we got attacked in Orlando. And Ja'Kari Jackson, when he was in Atlanta, and when Joe Biggs was in Dallas, and Michael Zimmerman yesterday talking to the anti-Trump people, that's one of the most common things they say, is that he's the reason we're getting attacked, he's the reason Orlando happened, and he's the reason the economy is in the outhouse. So this is just crazy that they will push lies this wild. But I tell you, I was talking to Darren McBreen yesterday, one of our great news analysts and editors, and he's going to do a piece on it. He said, well, I'm kind of embarrassed. I said, why be embarrassed? It happened to you. This guy's worked for some of the biggest news companies in the country, you know, managed hundreds of people, a great guy. He's paid pretty good at InfoWars, but he doesn't want to get Obamacare. He doesn't want to pay what the insurance is now because it's a big scam. For 3 years, he's been fined. First $800, then $1,600. Now they're going to fine him even more, and it's the IRS that's coming after him. Remember Obama 5, 6 years ago saying it was a conspiracy theory and racist to say that there were fines in there or that the IRS was hiring 18,000 people to enforce it? Just that part? It was in the bill. It was in the bill. All we did was show the bill. They passed the bill. In the first year of Obamacare, the Wall Street Journal reported of all major insurance companies, on average, went up 47%. Plus percent, like 47.9, memory serves, on us. just screwing us globally, they made that much money. But it's okay because it's liberal and Obama's black. This has nothing to do with it. It's a total scam. So Behar's blaming Trump. All this other insanity is going on. The former CIA director comes out and says he's the biggest recruiter and says he's never heard of U.S. troops handing out pallets of cash to the Iraqis. That was on the news in 2003. That's how they got the insurgency to stand down at first. It was reportedly $20 billion, then another $40 billion. The numbers vary, but upwards of $60 billion or more paid in C-130s full of $120 bills. That was on the news. You can pull that up and show people. Panetta says he never heard of such a thing as the former head of the CIA. Because they know the general public doesn't understand this stuff or doesn't have the attention span or the memory of a goldfish. New scientific studies, the average American has less of an attention span than a goldfish. Less than 7 seconds. Now, I know our audience, because we can see time spent listening. The average time spent listening for radio is about 8 minutes now. Our average is about 27 minutes. You are already the creme de la creme of people with attention spans. But that's why, on average, you earn more. It's why you give more charity on average. We have all the metrics from Google. It's why you are more aggressive, more healthy, more satisfied, because you still have a brain, just like I do. And again, I'm not claiming I'm some rocket scientist here. This is just getting crazy. And this is a battle between the giant, dumbed-down, mindless, idiot hordes and the American people who are still somewhat awake. And for them to aid ISIS, Hillary and Obama and the globalists, and when Panetta was in, they were doing it too, and to give them billions of dollars, they were formerly Al-Qaeda, turn Libya over to them, turn part of Syria over to them, part of Iraq over to them, let them set up this Saudi-backed caliphate, and to let them take over and overthrow our allies in Egypt, and then sit there and blame Donald J. Trump? But again, if they succeed in this, this is the great triumph of ignorance. This is the great triumph of mindlessness. This is the great triumph of idiocy. Just like Jakari has the poor black man on tape, you know, debating the other young black man who's destroying him, and he says Donald Trump wants to ship Africans back to Africa, black people back to, I mean, it's the most, it's just pure lies. But the guy's freaked out and believes it because he's being lied to in a trance state by the mainstream media and is genuinely freaked out. He's not even a bad person, but he's a victim of this idiocy. The good news is it only takes 3% to win a fight against the globalist. But I want to win an economic war. I want to win a renaissance war, a war of intellectual ideas. And most revolutions are intellectual. They're just not called revolutions because they're won peacefully. Most successful revolutions are cultural. The communists know this. They try to train us through Hollywood and media and culture that we're supposed to go fight like the Running Man, where Schwarzenegger, you know, defeats the corrupt fascist government all by himself. That's not how this works. Ladies and gentlemen, we have to come together and realize we're being lied to, shift out of the paradigm. If you believe Obama loves you, and you believe the Republican leadership loves you, you're in a trance, you're a chump. That's a fact. It's not my opinion. And you need to understand you're being lied to about Obamacare and about the NSA and about the open borders and everything else that's happening. You need to realize Donald Trump isn't perfect, but he isn't out to get America. And he realizes America's being destroyed on the altar of globalism, and he's speaking out against it. And that's why I'm supporting him. Now, there's a lot going on today. We have a lot of videos, incredible stuff that Joe Biggs and Zimmerman got in Dallas. Great job to them. So much jam-packed show coming up. I shot a special report last night, actually two of them, that we're going to be airing today. David Knight's coming up. I'm going to be doing live reports Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday when I'm on the road. So much is going on. So much is happening. Thank you all for your support. Infowars.com/show. Send that link out to everybody. The Tim Kennedy 15% off special on Brainforce, Secret 12, and Supernova Vitality is running through the middle of next week. Take advantage of that because we empower you while you empower us. The very best products. 20% off on Alexa Pure Water Filters is about to end. Take advantage of that. InfowarsLive.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. When you buy these products, you're buying war bonds in the battle for the Republic. So thank you all for your support. God bless you all. Now back to Paul Watson from London, England, live with the InfoWar.
There's Alex Jones filing a special report from the road. Now, in a moment, we're going to throw to my video, which I uploaded last night. This is a really important video. Dear gays, the left betrayed you on Islam. Of course, in the aftermath of the Colorado shooting, we've had many people defecting to Trump. But before we do that, I just want to mention the Tim Kennedy special. This is 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com. As part of our partnership with Special Forces operator and UFC fighter Tim Kennedy, we're giving you 15% off on the top InfoWars Life formulas used by Tim Kennedy. Get 15% off on Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com now for a limited time. These are the products that Tim Kennedy uses in his Special Forces and UFC training that help him go to the next level. And you can go and see the independent reviews, 4 5-star reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. Of course, all this goes to hiring more reporters, sending them out into the field. You've seen how prolific we've been with the content from the Trump rallies, from places like Bilderberg, other events, challenging the mainstream media. In the case of Bilderberg, being there in place of the mainstream media because they're too lazy to even send anyone along. And of course, the Trump rallies have completely shifted the narrative back from a few months ago where the violence and the media carried this narrative dutifully was being blamed on Trump himself, Trump supporters. We shifted that narrative by getting in the faces of these violent, vile social justice warriors, leading to the birth of the legend of Aid Skrillex, Carl LeCuc, and many others. So your support has visibly helped us do that, and we want to continue in the same vein. So go to InfoWarsLife.com to get the products and supporters. Now, I'm going to go to this video shortly, and it will conclude after the break because it's about 7 minutes long. But this morning, this afternoon, I've been inundated with a ton of positive messages from gay people, from people within the LGBT community, again, expressing this desire, this intention to switch their vote for Trump because they've been completely abandoned by the left, by Hillary Clinton, by Obama's refusal to even name radical Islamic terrorism, by the refusal to point out that violent hatred towards gay people is a belief implicit within Islam. Not extremist Islam, not radical Islam, not jihadists and who go and shoot up nightclubs. This is a belief held by the majority of Muslims. They either want to see gay people behind bars or dead. And that's not me saying that. You can go and ask them. You can go to their conferences, as you will see in this video, where they are asked by an Islamic speaker. These are the punishments decreed by the Quran, by Allah, death for homosexuality. Do you agree with it? They all put their hands up. He asked them again, are you a moderate Muslim? You're not an extremist, you're a moderate Muslim. Yes, they all put their hands up. These are beliefs held by moderate Muslims. That article is relinked up at the top of drudgereport.com right now, alongside his story about 1 million Muslim migrants admitted to America under Obama's rule. So be sure and check that out as well. But we're going to go to this video now. Dear gays, the left betrayed you for Islam. Here's the clip. Adding a rainbow filter to your Facebook profile picture isn't a substitute for calling out Islam's violent hatred towards gays. Creating some lame, sappy hashtag like Pray for Orlando isn't going to stop Islam's violent hatred towards gays. Tweeting hashtag Pray for Orlando so you can virtue signal to your friends about how compassionate you are isn't going to stop Islam's violent hatred towards gays. Attending a candlelit vigil so you can smear your Facebook profile with selfies for social approval isn't going to stop Islam's violent hatred towards gays. Tweeting hashtag love is love to get one over on right-wing Christians isn't going to stop Islam's violent hatred towards gays. Tweeting hashtag love is love while you denounce those who stand up for gay rights in Muslim countries as Islamophobes is not activism. Risking your life to speak out against actual oppression of gays in Muslim countries is. Labeling people who draw attention to Islam's rampant homophobia as divisive isn't going to stop Islam's violent hatred towards gays. Calling the Orlando massacre a mass shooting so you can demonize the Second Amendment and absolve Islam of blame isn't going to stop Islam's violent hatred towards gays, equating Christians who refuse to bake gay wedding cakes with jihadists who gun down homosexuals in cold blood. Isn't an argument. Hugging a Muslim isn't going to stop an ideology that literally wants to destroy Western civilization. But Omar Mateen is an extremist. How dare you blame all Muslims for terrorism? Really? So you think Islam's hatred for homosexuals is a belief only held by extremists?
They always can come with the same accusations. This speaker supports death penalty for homosexuals. This speaker supports death penalty for this crime or this crime or that. He is homophobic. They subjugate women, etc., etc., etc. It's the same old stuff coming all the time. And we always try to tell them, I always try to tell them that, look, it's not that speaker that we're inviting who has these extreme radical views, as you say. These are general views that every Muslim actually has. Every Muslim believes in these things. Just because they're not telling you about it, or just because they're not out there in the media, doesn't mean they don't believe in them. So I will ask you, everyone in the room, how many of you are normal Muslims? You're not extremist, you're not radical, this is normal Sunni Muslims. Please raise your hands. Everybody, mashallah, subhanallah. Okay, take down your hands again. How many of you agree that men and women should sit separate? Please raise your hands.
Sisters in particular.
Everyone agree. Everyone agree, brothers and sisters, subhanAllah. So it's not just these radical sheikhs then. Allahu Akbar. Next question. How many of you agree that the punishments described in the Quran and the Sunnah, whether it is death, whether it is stoning for adultery, whatever it is, if it is from Allah and His Messenger, that is the best punishment ever possible for humankind, and that is what we should apply in the world? Who agrees with that? Allahu Akbar. Are you all radical extremists? Subhanallah. So all of you are saying that you are common Muslims, you all go to the different masajids, no way. Or are you like a specific sect, like the IslamNet sect or anything like that? Are you like that? No. Are you like that? Please raise your hand if you like this extreme IslamNet sect or anything like that. No one. Allahu Akbar. How many of you just go to these normal masajids in Norway, the normal Sunni mosques? Please raise your hands. Allahu Akbar.
In case you missed that, let me explain it to you. You just watched a room full of so-called moderate Muslims in a Western country unanimously agree that all gays should be executed. Do I need to talk to you about the Muslim cleric at an Orlando mosque who called for all gays to be executed just weeks before Mateen's massacre? Do I need to talk to you about how 52% of Muslims in the UK think homosexuality should be criminalized? About how Turkish media called the Pulse nightclub victims perverts? About how Al Jazeera viewers lauded the massacre? About how Muslims on Twitter celebrated the slaughter? LGBT community, the regressive left does not have your back. While telling you to obsess over transgender bathrooms and gender-neutral pronouns, they're making an alliance with people who literally want to criminalize your lifestyle. They're joining forces with the belief system.
Okay, we'll be back after the break with the conclusion of that video. Again, the left has chosen to protect the feelings of Muslims over the lives of gay people. We'll be back after the break. Stay tuned.
Well, for years, the left has taught gays, has told gays to obsess about transgender bathrooms, about gender-neutral pronouns. They've told them to be weak, to not have self-defense, to accept, to embrace an ideology that literally wants to put them behind bars for their lifestyle, that literally wants to kill them for who they choose to have consensual sex with. They've been told to embrace that. They've been told
you're lower on the totem pole of the oppression Olympics than Muslims, so you better bow down. Now, the Drudge Report has the headline right at the top right now. Islamic speaker admits killing gays is a belief held by moderate Muslims. That is the clip that you just heard out of that video where they're in Norway, they're in a Western country. The speaker asks the moderate Muslims, are you extremists? Do you go to normal mosques? They're not extremists. In their own words, they go to normal mosques. He says, do you support things like the death penalty for homosexuals and adulterers? They all raise their hands. This is not extremist Islam. This is moderate Islam. Let's finish the video. Here it is. LGBT community, the regressive left does not have your back. While telling you to obsess over transgender bathrooms and gender-neutral pronouns, they're making an alliance with people who literally want to criminalize your lifestyle. They're joining forces with a belief system that prescribes death for your consensual sexual choices. They're lobbying to import millions more people to the West who totally despise you. The left has chosen to protect the feelings of Muslims over protecting the lives of gay people. The left would rather make excuses for a belief system that led to the slaughter of 49 innocent people at a gay nightclub than, God forbid, being called Islamophobic. That's why legions of gay people are vowing to switch their support to Trump in the aftermath of Orlando. And even if you hate Trump, you should also hate the regressive left, because they've sold you out. They've stabbed you in the back. So leftists, please stop with the virtue signaling, the pointless hashtags, the candlelit vigils. The cliche is really wearing thin, just like they sacrificed Western civilization in exchange for political correctness. The left has sacrificed the safety of gay people on the altar of multiculturalism, lowering the drawbridge for the monoculture of Islam that is completely intolerant of any kind of diversity and would rather see gay people behind bars or dead. There's the video. And again, this is what they've taught the LGBT community. You must embrace Islam in the name of diversity. They're embracing a monoculture that completely rejects diversity, that is completely intolerant of their very alternative lifestyles. But what's positive about this is you saw after Colorado, people switching their vote to Trump, gay people. And in fact, I've received a ton of messages just this morning from people responding to the video that you just heard, making the same sentiments. I'm going to read one here. I'm a gay conservative and I love you. I went to a candlelit vigil and was absolutely appalled by the way they classified everyone into little groups and hijacked the event to talk about Black Lives Matter and trans bathrooms. Then they had an imam from the local mosque come up and speak about how could this happen? What could make a person be filled with so much hate? Well, I think we both know what that is. He goes on, honestly, I was just shocked and I came away feeling even more depressed and less like a member of the supposed gay community. As a gay conservative in the arts, I have to somewhat keep my political views in the closet, lest I be ostracized by all the other local musicians and artists. And it goes on, and again, that's the key point. Leftists are completely intolerant of people with different opinions. But what's positive is that now a lot of people within the LGBT crowd are finally starting to see the light. They're being red-pilled. They're coming over to the side of freedom. We'll be right back. We are back. It's the second hour of the Alex Jones Show. David Knight is coming up at the bottom of the hour to take it in a different direction to cover some other news stories. Alex will be back in the next segment with another special report. So we're going to hit a few more news stories in this short segment. This is out of Information Liberation. Gun store owner, we called FBI and warned them about Orlando shooter. Now we know that Omar Mateen, and that's Orlando, not Colorado, as I've been saying, that was a mistake, Orlando shooting. We knew that the shooter was under FBI surveillance for years beforehand. They kind of brushed it off. They let him go. They said he was making these inflammatory statements, but there was no actual crime being committed. Well, now the co-owner of a Florida gun store says his employees contacted law enforcement before the Orlando shooting after gunman Omar Mateen attempted to purchase body armor and ammunition. Now, this was 4 or 5 weeks ago. This wasn't 3 years ago. It was 4 or 5 weeks ago. He goes into this gun store. He asks for level 3 body armor. but the store didn't carry it. Then, crucially, he made a phone call in Arabic before asking for bulk ammunition. So again, we've seen the reports. We've seen the analysis. There's no way this guy could have carried so much ammunition. There's no way he could have achieved the bloodshed that he did in Orlando without some kind of help. There have been reports of perhaps security guards helping him out, calls being made. In this instance, 4 weeks before the shooting, when he was trying to buy the ammo, the body armor, he was making calls in Arabic. Again, clearly suggesting a wider plot. But they don't even want to entertain the notion that there's a wider Islamist plot, because it would shift the narrative further away from gun control. You know, in Molenbeek, Belgium, in Brussels, you can get a military-grade weapon on the streets in hours for 400 euros. They had no problem acquiring military-style weapons in Paris to carry out that massacre, which, of course, is one of the strictest gun control regulation places in Europe. So again, this is not about gun control. They've tried to strong-arm that narrative into it. But if it came out that there were more shooters, that there were accomplices, which a lot of credible people are saying, that would demolish their narrative to an even greater degree. We've also got censorship in the aftermath of Orlando. Facebook bans gay magazine critical of Islam. This is out of Breitbart. Facebook has banned the page of gay magazine Gaystream after they published an article critical of Islam in the wake of the Orlando massacre. Well, how dare they? And all they did basically was criticize this Green Party individual out of Germany who said that he was more afraid of white Germans than Muslims. Now, last time I checked, white Germans don't get together and have huge conferences and all agree that gay people should be put in prison or killed, but maybe they do. Maybe I haven't seen those conferences. So all this gay magazine did was criticize this politician for making those comments. It was immediately banned on Facebook. Mark Zuckerberg wasn't having any of it. And then we have this, again out of Breitbart. Reddit will adjust algorithm to censor Trump supporters following Orlando shootings. So basically, the Donald Reddit, which I did an AMA on a couple of weeks ago, Alex did one a few days ago, they were completely dominating the front page of Reddit because people are sick to the back teeth of being censored. So in the name of fairness, in the name of what they said was diversity, they simply changed their algorithm to relegate the Donald's content. This is a subreddit. And they relegated people making comments about the Orlando shooting, saying that the guy was a Muslim. That was deemed speculative. Those comments were relegated. In some cases, people had their accounts terminated. Again, this is the key time right after these shootings. I'm going to go on to talk about it with Brexit and this Joe Cox killing. The immediate aftermath of the shootings is when the narrative is formed. And it's very difficult to change that narrative afterwards, even if the facts are completely on your side, which is why they're so intent on censorship in the immediate aftermath of any of these kind of mass shooting events. We'll be back to talk about Brexit.
There's a new spin demonizing Donald Trump. Vanity Fair and hundreds of other publications are saying Trump really ran for president. That is, they're implying he ran for president to garner a giant database of populist supporters, to launch a media empire on cable television that would rival or even dominate Fox News. But if you actually read what Trump is saying, he's just sick of going on Fox and CNN and seeing him make tens of millions of dollars per debate or event while they badmouth him. And he is talking about launching his own type of media system to deliver news during the election. Some are saying, hey, that violates campaign finance laws. Well, foreign corporations and the Saudis own much of Twitter and Fox News. Why couldn't Donald Trump, with his own money, set up his own media system? Then it would be people democratically deciding to tune in to decide whether or not it was successful. Look, they call for campaign finance reform all day long, but it's only because the establishment thinks they have it all sewn up. They're scared of a dark horse like a Donald Trump coming in with his own money and launching a brand of nationalist populism that they can't compete with. They're dying. They're falling apart. Donald Trump sees a vacuum. So does InfoWars.com. And into that vacuum, We simply hope to breathe a breath of fresh air into our free republic and the world, because we have goodwill for humanity. And we also want to see America succeed and be successful. But before America can be great again, America must be free again. Find the links to the live transmission. The resistance is in full swing. The counter-revolution is live at Infowars.com, because there's a war on for your mind. One more important item to cover on this live Friday show is that Media Matters, openly run by the Clintons in the White House, says that MSNBC panel rips Donald Trump's racist insinuation that Obama supports terrorism. Ladies and gentlemen, it's admitted that Obama has funded ISIS and Al-Qaeda. It's been declassified. It's all over the news. Cy Hirsch, Pulitzer Prize winner, has talked about it. Now, when they got embarrassed by it, they changed the name from Al-Qaeda to ISIS about 3 years ago. But this is what's going on. This is happening. And they use a word like racist. They said, if you read the Obamacare bill, how it gave fines and fees to people that didn't give it, you were racist in making it up. Or that if you said it didn't cut your premiums to zero, you were a liar. Of course, it came out that it did increase premiums and wouldn't let you keep your doctor and did put fines on you. But in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. And as long as the public's ignorant, these predators can continue to lie to the people. It's truly sickening. All right, back to the live transmission with Paul Watson, David Knight, and the InfoWar.
We are back. It's the Alex Jones Show live, now being joined by David Knight, of course, to discuss this incident yesterday, which was the Labour MP Jo Cox, again, tragically murdered in the north of England. She was a pro-Remain campaigner. She was campaigning for the side that wants to remain in the European Union. And again, this didn't happen in a vacuum. You look at the polls. Vote Leave was ahead. The polls were showing, in some cases, 19 points ahead. And more recent polls show 4 to 7 points ahead. But they swung it round completely. Before that, the Vote Remain camp was ahead. Again, why is this important? Because it would deal a massive blow to the entire globalist agenda. This is part of the populist revolution sweeping the West. It's not only happening in America with Trump. It's happening in Europe with the rise of all these conservative parties. So this vote next week on the 23rd is a huge, huge deal. This could set their agenda back decades. So obviously they have an interest to exploit whatever circumstances possible to try and desperately rescue this situation. Now, if you're losing the debate, if you're losing the argument on immigration, on the economy, on sovereignty, as it applies to the European Union, then what do you do? Well, you exploit the tragic murder of someone to make political grist. That's exactly what they've done. I'm going to get more into the details and the latest in a moment. But David Knight, what's your take on this Jo Cox murder?
You know, you're absolutely right, Paul. This is an issue that is of international importance, because our election here in the United States is one really that boils down to globalism versus nationalism. We're going to lose any chance that we have of restoring individual liberty if power gets more and more consolidated. And of course, if Britain will leave the European Union, then one of these major blocks of consolidation, the European Union, towards global governance starts to unravel. And we've seen efforts, as you mentioned, throughout Europe, different areas talking about the same type of thing. So this could create momentum, and they did have momentum, and now it looks like that may get lost. This happens exactly 1 week before the election. And I think, Paul, it's there may be something more to this than just saying using this for their own purposes. Now, the Wall Street Journal reports the killing of Jo Cox silences both sides ahead of the UK vote on EU membership. They're going to have a massive memorial service for her on Monday, but it hasn't really silenced them, Paul. We've got Prime Minister Cameron, who, as you know, has been pushing for them to remain in the European Union. He said today, our nation is rightly shocked. Where we see hatred, where we see division, where we see intolerance, we must drive it from our politics and out of our public life and out of our communities. You say, They were losing, and as you pointed out, Paul, you know, they came up with a new strategy. What is that? Wait for it. Racism. That's what Alex Jones is just talking about. And so what they do is they create a narrative where the Remain people, where the European Union, where the globalists are just peaceful and inclusive. But the other people who want to have the right of self-government, they're just racist and violent. We've had David Cameron making all kinds of desperate claims that there was going to be a physical war in Europe if Britain got out of the European Union. He said there was going to be economic disaster inside of Britain. He also said you're going to see interest rates go up. I mean, he's had this project of fear. And if you look at the way the media is reporting this, Paul, it's not just the Wall Street Journal saying that it is silenced. And it has, again, hasn't silenced both sides. The other side is talking about hate. They're talking about their grief and so forth and so on. But I think what's interesting, Paul, is a report from CNN. Now, it hasn't been talked about that this guy is a mental patient. Has it been talked about much over there in the UK?
No, it's actively being covered up. I mean, there are, you know, Breitbart's reported on it and so forth. But as you said, they've not suspended their campaign. They've become even more vociferous,
yes,
despite the fact that this guy was a mental patient. He had mental problems. He was on psychotropic drugs. They interviewed his friends. They interviewed his neighbors. They interviewed his family members. Listen to these quotes from his brother. Quote, "We are struggling to believe what has happened. My brother is not a violent man and is not that political. We don't even know who he votes for." Yeah. I'm visibly shaken by this news. Here's another one from his half-brother, yeah, who is half-black, I believe. "He's never expressed any views about Britain or politics or racist tendencies. And yet they're claiming, based on one eyewitness, who is a guy who is in the BNP, which is basically a fascist party, who, you know, he's got the motivation to make this claim for his own agenda, claimed that as this killer was shooting the Labour MP, that he was shouting Britain first." Mm-hmm. They went back and interviewed the other eyewitnesses who said he said no such thing. And in fact, the shopkeeper who's right across from where the murder happened put a huge note up in his window, and this is on my Twitter profile, saying that he did not say Britain first. It was not a political murder. This was a mentally unstable guy, hopped up on psychotropic drugs. Yet, mm-hmm, what have we seen in the aftermath? Complete, salacious, shameful exploitation by the politicians, by the media. Before this woman, this mother of two, was even dead, you had newspaper headlines saying Brexit killer. I mean, this is completely shameful. We expect nothing less from the mainstream media, but this is so transparent how they're hijacking it. They haven't suspended their campaign. They've become even more vociferous.
You're talking about how transparent it is, Paul. You're talking about how transparent it is. We've got the Southern Poverty Law Center, the usual suspects, who are now coming in and talking about how this guy was a racist. I mean, that raises all kinds of red flags when you combine that with what you just talked about in terms of interviewing people there. Neighbors. Here's another quote. This is from CNN, even. And CNN puts out the narrative that he's a lone killer, that there's a racist connection with it. Southern Poverty Law Center said they've got documents showing that he has a history of purchasing hate literature from the United States. I mean, these are the people who are always there to create this narrative of right-wing extremism, the Southern Poverty Law Center. But listen to what the neighbors who knew him said. This is Diana Peters, a 65-year-old neighbor, said there was nothing to indicate this could happen. Exactly what you were just saying, Paul. She says it's a total surprise he was even capable of thought, let alone action. Okay, said another longtime neighbor. Another one says, he was just the ideal neighbor, helpful when you wanted it, kept to himself. She said that he taught English to foreigners. You mentioned he had a half-black brother, Paul. He taught English to foreigners. Politics never came up in a conversation. We never talked about anything like that, said his neighbor. She said she never saw anyone visiting his home. She said she believed that he visited his mother every Sunday, took her groceries once a week, described him as very meek and mild. He spoke rationally. He did his day-to-day routines. But I thought it was interesting. One of the things that came out was a 6-year-old interview that was published in the paper. They were talking to patients from a mental institute who had been given day jobs, and they were finding them day jobs doing gardening work. And we'll tell you what that says when we come back. We've got to go to break. I'm David Knight, and we got Paul Joseph Watson in the UK. Both of us will be right back, and we'll tell you the real story behind this shooting. This guy looks like a total patsy, like straight out of Being There. If you remember Chance the Gardener, Peter Sellers' character. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight here in Austin. We have Paul Joseph Watson with us for one more segment from the UK. And we have Alex Jones is going to be joining us with a special report in the next, when we come back after break in the next segment. Of course, NATO, and this is what Alex is going to be talking about, NATO just came out and said that if there was a cyber hack against one of its countries, that would be grounds to start a physical war. No, we're not trying to push war, are we? We're just these peace-loving people. This is a very, very dangerous hair trigger that they have set up, and Alex is going to be talking about that in the next section. Paul, one of the other news articles I saw coming out of the UK that's about the Brexit vote, and of course, the Brexit vote is going to be a week from yesterday. Everything has been silenced now in the wake of this murder of this member of parliament who supported Remain. But there was this article I saw on Breitbart. London's Muslim mayor is having Remain rallies, and he's doing it with hijab-clad women who are standing in the background. So it's kind of, I guess you could say that he's backing Remain, but he's having the hijab women remain in the back, Paul.
Well, I mean, it's like we saw with the video clip I played earlier. That's the fundamental belief of Islam, segregation. So you've got all the men at the front, you've got all the women relegated to the back. And, you know, he's from Tooting, which is one of these Islamic ghettos, basically. You can walk down the street, you know, it's a halal butcher, an Islamic bookstore, a mosque. This is one of the areas that has been completely taken over. It's not about diversity. As I said, this is a monoculture. They don't embrace diversity, yet we're supposed to embrace diversity. Another thing with the Brexit, of course, you had numerous people, Christine Lagarde of the IMF, you had Alain Juppé, this left-wing French presidential candidate, you had an EU commissioner, all come out within hours of the murder of Joe Cox and say that, for example, with the EU commissioner, Dimitris Avramopoulos, quote, she was murdered for her dedication to European democracy and humanity. Alain Juppé said she was, quote, shamefully murdered because of her beliefs. This guy was a mentally ill person on drugs with no political history. Yes. The closest people to him said he wasn't political at all. The eyewitnesses said that the claims he said Britain first were completely wrong. The one person they've got who said that is a BNP member, yet they're running with it. Yeah. They exploited this within minutes, which shows you exactly. I mean, their entire campaign is not based on having a fair debate. This should be about immigration, jobs, the economy, sovereignty.
That's right.
Their campaign is so discredited, it's so crumbling that they've had to basically dance on the grave of this poor dead woman to try and reinvigorate their campaign. And this is the same crowd that says, you know, after every Islamist terror attack, not all Muslims, don't blame all Muslims. Yet in the immediate aftermath of this, they blamed all Vote Leave supporters. Absolutely shameful. And it's still going on.
Oh, yeah. Just like in the United States, they say don't blame Muslims, and yet they blame all gun owners. For what's happened there. We're the ones who need to have our guns taken away. And as the Wall Street Journal is saying, and of course the Wall Street Journal and all the financial community and the bankers who want this globalism, they want Britain to stay in the European Union. They're saying, well, this silences both sides. As you point out, it hasn't silenced the people who want Britain to remain. They've been using this vociferously and continuously, but the people who have been silenced are the people who were there saying that we need to leave, we need to be independent. They are the ones who are being silenced, and they're going to be silenced because for this entire next weekend, as well as going through the memorial service next Monday, everything leading up to it, all the narrative is going to be about how people who want to leave are nothing but hateful racist. And that's why we've got the Southern Poverty Law Center jumping in with a bunch of bogus, doubtful information with us.
Yeah, and now you've got Angela Merkel coming out. She's not being silent. She's come out and said that it, you know, it characterizes the radical atmosphere of the rhetoric that surrounds this whole conversation about Europe. Well, this is the same woman whose policy brought in 1 million plus Muslim migrants into Germany, a lot of them who are Syrian. Polls show 21% of Syrians support ISIS. So she's literally bringing in hundreds of thousands of people who are radicalized, who support ISIS, who want the death penalty for gay people, who want Sharia law. And yet she's blaming people who simply want to reclaim some essence of sovereignty and freedom back for themselves, for their parliamentary democracy. She's saying that they're the radicals. Again, absolutely absurd that this statement would come from her. They're dancing on the grave. They're exploiting this, and it's shameful.
You know, we had former mayor of London, Boris Johnson, who favors Britain becoming a sovereign nation again. And he gave 8 reasons why Britain would be better off with an exit. And as you're talking about this, Paul, the people, as part of the Leave campaign, came up with very concrete proposals, talking about how much money was going to be put back into the national health system and so forth and so on, showing the economic benefits. And that has all been shut down. And what's the usual tactic from the usual suspects? Racism. Thank you so much, Paul Joseph Watson. We're going to be joined by Alex Jones in the next segment. He's going to talk about cyber war. The
Empire. Yesterday on Thursday, I broke down official NATO statements, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, where they threatened Russia with military responses if anyone inside Russia or a Russian protectorate hacks an individual, a corporation, or a governmental institution that is, quote, protected by the umbrella of NATO. A lot of things come to mind when I read that. In an official statement from NATO, as a new defense policy, their new stance, their new rules of engagement. NATO, for 5 years, has been funding the Arab Spring, Al-Qaeda, ISIS, and Saudi Arabian invasions of North Africa, Northeast Africa, the Middle East, Central Asia, you name it. NATO has been involved in toppling nations like Libya and, of course, trying to topple Syria and successfully for a few years toppling Egypt to put in the Muslim Brotherhood and other Wahhabist groups. Then they have the nerve to tell Russia, that has 3 foreign military bases, that it is trying to start a world war. They use these terms. And we see the head of NATO and others saying we need to see Russian body bags to counter this. I'm not a Russophile. I've never been to Russia. I don't have any Slavic blood in me. I'm not rooting for the Ruskies. My daddy took me when I was a kid to hear Ronald Reagan speeches at Fair Park and places in Dallas. Most of my family's been in the U.S. military. It's just that Russia isn't starting the wars. And this is a fact that our government, run by George Soros, overthrew Ukraine 3 years ago, put fascists in, overthrew an elected government, and then our media said Russia had done it. This is getting crazier and crazier. So I want to go over a few of these articles just to illustrate how out of control the globalists are and how they're the ones endangering humanity. I tend to do this every day on the syndicated radio/TV show, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m., and I'll use Infowars.com as an example or DrudgeReport.com, 2 sites that give you a wide range of articles. But the way Drudge lays it out is truly populist. AR-15s flying off the shelves. Now rainbow flags are out with the Don't Tread on Me symbol, the Culpepper symbol. That's got to make them mad, saying hashtag shoot back. Sales surge among gays and lesbians across the country buying guns. Biggest sales ever. West Hollywood inundated with pro-gun, pro-gay posters. Calls for expanded watch list test civil liberties. Yeah, you want to put gun ownership into the whole watch list of flights. It's all extrajudicial. It's all completely and totally outside of due process. But Bloomberg, who wants our guns, openly admits, though, that it tests civil liberties and violates due process. CIA warns ISIS is coming. Well, yeah, you help bring them in. Countries in visa-free travel program not sharing terror info. Algorithm aims to predict attacks. Well, how about it's Muslims? 441 Syrian refugees admitted to the U.S. since Orlando attack. 5 days ago, White House sees surge in coming months. Iraqi man clutching Quran harassers diners at Texas IHOP. Now look at this. Trump storms Texas. We have reporters there. Those reports are about to be played here on the air with David Knight and Paul Joseph Watson hosting. But as we continue, Mexican flags fly at Trump protest
in Dallas. Again, Trump points out that this judge ruling against him is a member of La Raza involved in a group suing him and boycotting him. He should recuse himself. But here we have the American Mirror reporting on the Mexican flags that are flying there. I mean, if Mexico's so wonderful, why don't you go there? But I get it, under La Reconquista, Texas, under the Guadalupe Hidalgo Treaty, you know, previous to that, it's all been stolen. 6 days later, Berlin frets about EU influence if UK leaves it. Trans for Trump, Facebook page suspended. More censorship. Border battle, the members of the unofficial patrol, Senator Sessions, who's probably going to be the VP of Trump, says that the members of the unofficial patrol are basically patriots. And Senator Sessions says, dictator Obama flooding rural towns with illegals. Yes, outside of law, having them complete the smuggling process. But don't worry, federal government approves higher fence for the White House. And California's new motor voter law would have 2 million registered voters in the first year. Okay, that's just some of the news I want to cover. We'll get to more of that in just a moment. But Mexico has a wall. Mexico has a fence. 6 months to a year of hard labor. They torture the people they catch coming in illegal. I'm not saying that's a good thing. That's a bad thing. But we just can't offer free stuff to the world and then call Donald Trump racist if he's against it. I mean, that's just common sense. But continuing, here's another example. I told people back on Sunday and Monday that I bet it that the guy that went in and, you know, this crazy Taliban ISIS lover shooter whose dad goes on the internet and sells kill gays and his minister, his imam goes on there and says that. Now we learned that the Taliban is using honey trap boys to kill Afghan police because pedophilia and homosexuality is so incredibly over the top that that's how they go lure Afghan police for Al-Qaeda and the Taliban and the Pashtuns to kill them. Because when I first started reporting on this, which is well known, it's like saying you go to a Turkish jail, you get raped, that homosexuality is most common in Muslim countries. And you say, well, why do they kill them in Saudi Arabia, throw them off buildings when they find them in Syria or Egypt or Libya? It's because you're not supposed to admit you're doing it. And between men, it's dominating another man, or a boy, it's dominating. It's not supposed to be love. If you love them, it's then evil. So a truly sick system. I mean, if adults want to do something, that's their issue. That's why I'm attacked and called homophobic, because I don't want to kill anybody. Okay, fine. Or Islamophobic, because I don't want to have my, you know, my family put hoods over their heads. But in Islam, it's okay to kill people if they're homosexual. And man, the leftists just love it. We actually have clips of this. We played it yesterday with Ja'Kari Jackson in Atlanta a few days ago. And they got a guy with a gay pride, you know, rainbow flag, bitching out some black teenager who's a Trump supporter, saying, you know, how dare you? Trump wants to send blacks back to Africa, and he's in the Klan. All this made-up stuff. Well, he's wearing a rainbow flag when Trump's out there defending the rights of all Americans not to be killed. It's just all fantasy land. It's a bunch of domesticated, weak, stupid people who are on this big collectivist bent, believing government really cares about them and special interests really want to give them something free. As you get poorer, as you get dumber, as your worthless college degrees, you know, get you a job bagging groceries, you just can't admit you've been conned. And I remember a few cousins and business partners and people, I mean, probably up to five or six people I know, who went from getting angry at me to never talking to me again, because over 15, 16 years ago, I said, before everybody knew this, it was well known, but not totally known, wasn't absolutely known, that Nigerian fake emails from Prince Boo Boo or Ababa or Jabba Boo Boo, these are real fake names. I mean, I'm not joking. You've all gotten them. That you've just won $1 million. Just send me 5,000. Prince of Boo Boo needs it. And you're so honored that Prince of Boo Boo called you that you sent him 5,000. And they go, sorry, you can get the 2 million once you send us 20,000. Prince of Boo Boo appreciates you. And if you're dumb enough to send him 20,000 to get the 2 million, then you're going to actually get a call from Prince of Boo Boo. And then the call never comes. And these people will look at me and say, you're jealous that Prince Abubu chose, it's mainly women, he's coming to America. I'm going to marry Prince Abubu. Like your free Obamacare, all of it. It's like, God almighty, When you're a kid and the guy grabs the rabbit out of the hat, the magician, you think he really did it. When you're about 10 years old, your dad tells you, hey, there's a, see that table? There's an open door through the top of the hat. It opens. There's a trap door through the hat, through the, you know, and the hat does like this, trap door opens, there's a rabbit below, he pulls it out. And you look at your dad, you go, Dad, it's real magic. Shut up, conspiracy theorist. So I think people that doubt fake magic tricks are conspiracy theorists. Or, you know, if you doubt that, you know, Alice in Wonderland's real or Mary Poppins, I mean, it's just crazy. So how far into are we in this, dude?
7 minutes.
7 minutes. I'm going to finish this up, go back to Paul Watson and the rest of the crew. David Knight coming up that are co-hosting here on this Friday worldwide transmission. But just looking at some of this, you know, this is important. Look, genetic advances make sex obsolete. That's the plan. Genetically engineer everything with the glyphosates, the chemicals, where you can't have children. Then you got to go to the government and systems to have your child from three or four different parents, which they admit is the plan. And then they can build Trojan horses of social control into that. But let's look at some of the headlines from Infowars.com. This is on Thursday night. There'll be more live today, obviously. Dear gays, the left betrayed you. They always betrayed you, okay? I mean, it's just, they just saw you as chumps. Facebook suspends outspoken Florida gun shops after Orlando attack. Yeah, don't let them defend themselves. You know, shut them up. Petition to ban AR-15s and act stronger gun laws gains momentum. Because they got followed all the gun laws, had the registration, was a security guard with Homeland Security. His uncle, his father, his brother-in-law are all involved shipping the foreigners in. His dad goes to the White House. His dad hangs out with Congress. None of that matters that they're Afghans brought in by the CIA. Just like Obama said, American terror did this. Yes, Americans did it. Kind of like when some Moroccan guy stabs two in France, they go, the Frenchman killed. That ain't no Frenchman. That's a North African. So let's keep going right here. Pretty soon they'll say there were never any freshmen. All there are North Africans. So this is just some of the articles that deal with all of this. Police restrict reporters to free speech zones at Trump event. We have a bunch of videos that just got filed tonight and over tomorrow dealing with all this. But Black Lives Matter protesters arrested at Dallas Trump event. Cop admits violent protesters were busted into the rally. Mexican flag waving, anti-Trump. Trumpers become aggressive. We need to send that to drudgereport.com. Shocking police lock Trump supporters in parking lot. This is all breaking right now at Infowars.com. And you got Paul Watson's site breaking all of this down as well. So I'm basically going to end this transmission for now. There was another article on Drudge Report from the Daily Mail where they've got transhumanists meeting with the Pentagon about putting microchips in all the sailors and troops. You can say, oh, that's fine. We'll know where they're at. It brings total control. A cashless society is the technocracy's dream. You think Bank of America coming out saying they're going to tax you, you know, every time you do a money transfer, use your debit card is bad. Once they've gotten rid of cash, the sky's the limit. And that's what Bilderberg and the globalists are pushing. They have decided the easy path. Don't care about humanity. Screw everybody over, do whatever you want, be cynical, be evil. And then they say you're all dumb and weak and you deserve it, you're never going to stand up or care. My question is that really true? And the answer is it isn't. Even if they've turned maybe 60% of people into zombies, and I mean zombies, it doesn't matter. They still are beings that have due process rights. And then what about the rest of us that are awake and know what's going on that you're targeting and saying the bad guys? Infowars.com/show. As viewers and listeners, it's key you send that link out to everyone you know. They're doing everything they can to censor the web, to censor truth. They're banning rallies by people exposing Islam, just even moderate groups in Orlando. They're banning Twitters and Facebooks. They have the federal government saying they want to come after Infowars and Drudge. And you know, and people say, I don't care if they take you down. Well, we're the kind of the big elephants up front. They can shoot us. They can get everybody. We're also running specials right now at InfowarsStore.com. On Living Defense, it's about to sell out. That's 20-plus herbs. They're known to flush out parasites in your body. Everything I sell is a win-win. Fund our operation, fund Liberty, and give you stuff I know you really need. X2, the good halogen. 20% off on Alexa Pure Water Filter. So you don't drink all the glyphosates and garbage. That's going to end in a couple days. In fact, on Sunday, at InfowarsStore.com. Non-GMO heirloom seeds. Hillary for Prison shirts. When this crop of Hillary for Prison, until the end of time, sells out, that's another select classic limited edition. When that's gone, it's about to sell out, we have one more Hillary for Prison shirt. Then if she gets elected, let me impeach Hillary. But we've got one more limited edition coming on after that, and that's it for these shirts. And we need the funds. Look at us. We're putting everything in. Paul Watson, Rob Dew, Josh Owens deployed to Europe for 10 days. Reporters deployed to Dallas, L.A., Albuquerque, just New York, Philadelphia, Atlanta. I mean, we're on it. We're fighting hard. And we're not saying, oh, look at us. We're special. We're just fighting. We're doing everything we can. We appreciate your support. We appreciate your prayers. We appreciate you spreading the links. All of it's resistance. Whether you buy, you know, the good halogen to block the bad halogens, or Supermel Vitality, InfoWarsLife.com, or take advantage of the Tim Kennedy special we're running, 15% off on Brain Force, Supermel, or Methylcobalamin's Secret 12. Whatever you do at InfoWarsStore.com, or whether you send a link out to somebody, or whether you send a video to somebody, it's changing the world. I'm going to be on the road and taking a little bit of vacation, some fishing with my children, but I'll still be working part-time for the next week. And if you're watching or listening to this transmission, we're together. We believe in humanity. We have goodwill for each other, every race, color, creed. We're going to the stars, and we are the resistance, the globalist dehumanizers.
Okay, and that was Alex Jones. And, of course, he was mentioning at the very beginning of that broadcast how NATO is saying that if they're just hacked with a cyber attack, that could be the basis for a war. Isn't that amazing? I think about that. Think about how many cyber attacks we've had and how it's ultimately been traced back to our own government as a false flag. How could you do an easier false flag in order to start a war than to say we're going to do it with a cyber hack? That's something that ought to concern all of us. And of course, at the same time, they're saying if you come in and you hack our systems, that's an act of war. And yet, throughout social media, many of these outlets that were created by funding from our government, like Facebook and Google, we see rampant censorship and control of information. As Paul mentioned earlier, Reddit will adjust an algorithm to censor Trump supporters following the Orlando shooting. They're doing this in order to promote diversity, of course. And according to the Daily Beast, this is happening because they had 11,712 subscribed to the Trump-supporting subreddit on Sunday alone, making it the most successful day in the community's relatively short history. Okay, so how do you? What do? If you're Reddit, you don't want those eyeballs on your site. You don't want people signing up and using it, do you? No, no, no. If you have something really successful, you shut it down because the politics is more important to them than what they say they're doing there. Now, look at what Facebook is doing. We got Facebook, and this is a story from InfoWars.com, suspending outspoken Florida gun shops after the Orlando attack. They said, oh, you want to blame guns? You want to blame gun shops? Well, they spoke up and they said, no, I think the problem is Islam. As I've said many times, the lesson to learn, if you want to make people safer, this is not about gun control. We need to insist and change this narrative to make it about controlling the borders. What difference does it make if we're going to have background checks, for gun owners, if we don't have background checks at the borders? They want to talk about watch lists? What is a watch list? It's nothing but a glorified background check, if they did it right. But there's a far more things that we need to be concerned about the watch list. It is far more dangerous than guns in the hands of a government. We're going to tell you why when we come back. All right, welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Friday, June 17th, 2016. We have a lot we want to talk about. We're going to cover most of these stories coming up in the longer segments. So I want to talk about the watch list. Who's watching the government? You know, that's the old saying, the old philosophical saying, who watches the watchers? These are secret processes. And what we see coming out being revived is nothing new. It was put to us last August by Dianne Feinstein, Rhino, neocon extraordinaire, Peter King. And of course, this is nothing new in throughout history. We've always had the government with its secret courts, with its star chamber processes, accusing people in secret. This is the hallmark of totalitarianism. This is what was written, what Kafka wrote about in his novels, okay? What we're looking at with these watch lists is the most possible thing, dangerous thing that could happen to us. You need to be concerned about that far more than firearms. And I want to talk about, you know, we've heard that the Orlando shooting was the deadliest mass shooting in the United States history. No, actually, it wasn't, okay? It wasn't. Think about Wounded Knee, okay? How many people died in Wounded Knee? Well, that happened in 1890. You had the U.S. cavalry attack a village of Indians, men, women, and children, in a genocidal manner, shooting and killing everybody that was there. 150 Lakota in a single incident. Okay, so they could get their land, right? We've had, more recently, we've had the Waco shooting. We had 82 members of the Branch Davidians were murdered by our government. I believe deliberately, after a long siege, they decided they were fed up with it, burned them out, just like the Nazis burned out the Jews who were resisting them in the Warsaw Ghetto. Both events occurred on April the 19th. Maybe that's just a coincidence. Maybe not. Maybe that was a message that was sent. So that was 82 at Waco, 150 at Wounded Knee. And, of course, there's been other atrocities, hate crimes that were done in the past. We had, this is an article from Mint Press. They talk about how, you know, 49 people killed in Orlando, but there's been incidents where African-Americans were targeted, okay? 1917, at least 100 were killed in East St. Louis in one night. Another incident, anywhere from 55 to 300 blacks were massacred in Tulsa, Oklahoma, in just 16 hours in June of 1921. Because, see, they didn't have guns. There were those Jim Crow laws that kept guns away from black people. The Indians didn't have guns to defend themselves when the cavalry attacked them. And, of course, they used the pretense of guns to come after those at Waco, even though it was simply over a license for firearms. That's what the siege began with. But they did this full-blown attack, called up the media, said, hey, y'all, come watch this. We're going to show you how our SWAT team operates. And, of course, they'd had many incidents where they had served them with warrants peacefully, the local sheriff. But no, the BATF wanted to come in and do it. The key word was showtime. That's when we're going to kick off the raid. Showtime. We're going to show everybody how powerful we are. And they were paranoid, and they shot back and killed some agents. That began the siege, and then they just burned the place down. So, you know, when we talk about this, and we talk about the government murdering people, and it's not even the number of people that they murdered, because immediately preceding Waco, of course, we had Ruby Ridge, where an FBI hostage team sniper shot a woman who was holding a baby in her arms at what, for a sniper, was point-blank range. It was a very close range. Shot her right in the forehead. She slumped to the ground on her knees, still holding the baby dead. Okay? So you want to talk about atrocities? You want to talk about what you should really be afraid of? It's democide. It's our government killing people. That's why we have the Second Amendment. It's to keep them from doing it. We'll be right back.
U.S. cities with access to affordable housing and manufacturing jobs are quietly receiving the bulk of Obama's invading Islamic Jihad army, stretching unsuspecting local city budgets to the breaking point. Bold statement. Yesterday on the Alex Jones Show, retired DHS officer and whistleblower Philip Haney explained why radical Islamic terrorists are falling through the cracks despite unprecedented government data gathering.
When you encounter people coming back from flights from overseas, or when you're preparing to depart, to go outbound, we call it, to go overseas. We have the authority within the border, a greater amount of authority than the CIA and the FBI combined, to gather this kind of basic intelligence information. And over the years, we have been handcuffed more and more to the point where we're barely capable of gathering the kind of information that we could then share, let's say, with the FBI.
Some targeted American cities are already being pushed over the edge. For example, Amarillo, Texas, known as the Yellow Rose of Texas, one of the largest meatpacking cities in the United States, home to the V-22 Osprey hybrid aircraft assembly plant, food giant Cargill, and also home to Pantex, the only nuclear weapons assembly and disassembly plant in the United States, has taken in well over 1,000 Middle Eastern refugees already, the highest in the nation. But when you add refugees sent to Amarillo from countries outside the Middle East, the numbers skyrocket. WorldNet Daily reports Amarillo has received 5,251 foreign refugees since January of 2002, according to the Federal Refugee Database. That's more than half of the nearly 8,000 refugees sent to Texas during the same period. President Obama has increased that number of foreign refugees bound for American soil in fiscal 2016 to 85,000. That's a 20% increase over the previous year and 10,000 will be coming from the jihadist hotbed of Syria. Many of the community organizers have received training or consultation from David Lubell's Welcoming America organization, which was started with seed money from billionaire George Soros. Breitbart reported in January of 2016, Amarillo Mayor Paul Harpole said, "We've been a giving community, and it's a huge disservice to bring in refugees in numbers that we're not able to handle. We create small ghettos." The Amarillo, Texas mayor continues, "A group of Somalis came in to say that they had elected a mayor of their community. Then another faction claimed they had their own leader. We come to find out that rival tribes, slaves, and masters were being settled together. Amarillo 9/11 calls are now being fielded in 42 different languages." Harpole told Watchdog.org that Washington pays schools only $100 per refugee student per year. He continues, "We have 660 refugee kids who don't speak English, and the U.S. Department of Education says they have to be at grade level within 1 year. It's a ludicrous requirement. They don't even know how to use the bathroom." And while Governor Abbott and the Texas Health and Human Services Commission continue to push lawsuits against resettlement organizations and the federal government for not presenting regular consent as required by federal law, crime levels in Amarillo are reaching levels on par with much larger cities.
Amarillo also has the highest rate of reported rape in Texas. The rape epidemic in this world is becoming pandemic. It's not confined to one location.
Even the Muslim convert CIA director John Brennan has declared that terrorists are using the refugee system to infest the United States. Meanwhile, Amarillo immigrant Mohammed Maghadam, who came to Amarillo 8 years ago, recently held his manager and another person hostage at gunpoint because he was passed over.
Okay, and that's John Bowen's report. You can see the rest of that at the Walmart. Alex Jones channel.
A SWAT team responded.
Non-assimilating refugees flooding Amarillo, Texas. And of course, folks, we are not going to have homes. We're not going to be able to afford anything if we have to educate everyone who wants to come here for free. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Friday, June 17th, 2016. I'll be your host for the rest of the show. I want to go back and revisit something we were talking about and go into it a little bit more detail. We were talking about this with Paul Joseph Watson, this shooting that happened in the UK. And it was a tragedy. I mean, this is a lady who is a beloved wife and mother of two small children who is now dead. But I think there's something else to this. You know, just because people are dying at these events, just like the Aurora, Colorado shooting, a lot of people died there. There was a tragedy there. But we need to look at who these people are and what really happened here. I mean, wouldn't you want to know if your loved ones were killed for political purposes, like a Reichstag fire, a false flag purpose to forward a political agenda, if they were killed by cold-blooded murder? Rather than just a madman who was able to get his hands on guns so easily and we got to ban guns. No. Actually, you know, when that Aurora, Colorado shooting happened, I remember it very well because I was going to New York to cover the UN Arms Trade Treaty. And it was exactly 1 week before the UN was going to vote on that Arms Trade Treaty. They thought they had a pretty good shot at it. And I went there to do some filming for a gun group, the National Association of Gun Rights. And prior to that, of course, there had been the false flag, and it's admitted, even mainstream media admits that the Fast and Furious operation was a false flag by the American government to try to take away the Second Amendment, to put restrictions on it. And of course, that was precisely what the UN Arms Trade Treaty was about, restricting the flow of arms across borders. And of course, if you're going to do that, that means that you've got to track and follow and record every firearm cell within America, to make sure that nothing is coming or going that isn't allowed, okay? So it is a prescription just to say, well, we don't want small arms and big arms going across the borders. So in order to do that, the mechanism for that is going to be total information awareness, if you will, for guns. And that was what that was about. And so Fast and Furious was designed as a mean to say, you know, here's a problem, and we've got the solution right here. The UN has come up with this, and we've been talking about this for several years, so now it's time to vote on it. Well, that all blew up in their face when the federal agent was killed. It was exposed as a false flag. They no longer looked like they were going to be able to get this through. So then, bingo, 1 week before they're going to meet and vote on this. What happens? We have the Aurora, Colorado shooting. And nobody ever asks, when you look at this guy, James Holmes, this is a guy who, when he graduated from high school, he had a 3.949 average out of 4. Nearly a perfect average. He was in the top 1% of his class. Okay? He had highest honors. He was given a National Institute of Health scholarship just before all the shooting happened. How did this guy go from being so incredibly smart and intelligent? How did he go from that to being this kind of catatonic Jim Ignatowski? You know? I mean, you look at this guy, he's like, you know, his eyes are wide open. He's wearing an orange wig. He's is literally wigged out, okay? How did he get to that state? What flipped him? Do you ever see anybody in the mainstream media asking that question? What transformed James Holmes? How did that happen so quickly? How did he go from being a psychology major to some kind of a ninja prepper? Okay, and remember he said, oh, there's all kinds of bombs in my apartment. And they go back and the whole place is booby-trapped. There's all kinds of weapons there and so forth and so on. And where did he get the money for this? Where did he get the expertise for this? None of it made any sense. But the timing was perfect. It was 1 week before the UN Arms Trade Treaty. We needed to scare the American public about firearms, but it backfired. Instead, people went out and bought a lot more guns. But we still have people, even the fellow who engaged us down in San Antonio. Remember, we had the argument with Alex Jones. They were parents of one of the people who was killed in that movie theater. And instead of them asking the question, who or what changed James Holmes? Instead of asking, why did this happen? Why is this timing so suspicious? Instead, it's like, we need to stop guns. We need to make guns go away. And I understand that. But you know what? They're not going to go away. Drugs haven't gone away in 45 years of the drug war. You think the draconian measures that we've had in the drug war have made any change? Come on, people on the left, you know that hasn't worked. Why do you think that taking away guns is going to work? And I got to say the people on the right, why do you persist in the war on drugs? It's destroying our country. It's destroyed our due process. And now the war on terror is taking it the rest of the way. And we're going to talk about those terror watch lists and what you should really be afraid of when we come back. But I want to now go to this situation in the UK. And of course, this is a very, very important issue. Many of you may think this is something that only affects people in England, okay, the UK. The Brexit vote is not just a local issue. As Paul Joseph Watson was saying, this is reflecting a mass movement, a mass grassroots movement against globalism that is destroying our way of life, destroying our countries, taking away our freedoms, taking away our sovereignty, removing our control over government to a much more distant location. Whenever you lose your freedoms, and this is, you know, people say, hey, you know, how can you support Donald Trump? Because he's wrong on so many different civil liberties issues. And it's like, I understand. We can still fight for some of these civil liberty issues at the local and state level. We have legal mechanisms. I understand that the Bill of Rights and the Constitution are really a dead letter, but they still swear to it. They still take an oath to it. They still pretend that it's what gives them their authority. And as long as they do that, we've got an in. And it's also, if we understand what that document is about, it is the best plan we've come up with yet in any civilization to protect individual liberty. But the further we move our power away from the individual, when it goes from the individual to the community, the local community, from the local community to the state level, from the state level to the national level, from the national level to the global level, the farther it gets away from us, the more difficult it will be to ever recover that. And so right now, we're about to see our individual liberties be removed even further away from us. Going from the national to the international level, we're moving to the next step of globalism. That's why it's important. In Britain, they're fighting for their sovereignty, trying to get it back. They've already lost it. They come in and they say, well, look at all the money that we're sending to Brussels, to the European Union. What could we do with that in our own country? You know, they've got a national health system. They say, well, we could spend more money on that. We could help the poor in our own country. Look at how much we could do with that if we didn't have to send it to the European Union. They're writing our laws and regulations for us. They're writing the trade agreements for us. We don't have any say-so over how our economy is managed. That's why it's important. They're understanding that. There are other countries in Europe that are understanding that. Americans are understanding that. That's what's behind Donald Trump. And, of course, the people of Bilderberg, and these are people in North America and Europe who worked together to design the euro as well as the European Union, they are the ones who are creating this globalism, who are trying to move it to the next step, have a transatlantic union, economic first, then political, just as the European Union was economic first and then political and becoming more and more political as it goes along. So it is very important for them to start to unravel this plan at the bottom level. And they were winning. They were having a massive surge. And it was a trend that had been going on for a long time. The supporters of the European Union were losing miserably in debates. Cameron was failing left and right. Nobody was buying it. They could see what was happening. And at Bilderberg, they were very concerned about it. They're talking about the precariat. They say, we have this precarious proletariat, because they break everybody into classes and put them against each other. And it's not, you know, the Wall Street is not against Marxism. It was the bankers who sent Lenin to start the Russian Revolution. German bankers gave him $10 million, put him on a train to start the Russian Revolution. This is a known fact. It is a tool of social control. And so they look at this, they say, well, the proletariat is now getting pretty dangerous. These people are going to pick up pitchforks and torches pretty soon. They're going to come after us. What do we do to placate them? They're very concerned about that. And they're concerned that Britain was going to leave, and that was going to start unraveling the whole game. And so then we have this killing, just like the Aurora, Colorado shooting, 1 week before the vote. But they may win with this one, because people aren't going to go out. They're not really seeing what is behind this. This is the CNN story. They say, to neighbors, Tommy Mayer is a quiet man who tended gardens in the small town of Birstall in northern England. But details are slowly starting to emerge. Where are those details coming from? Not from his neighbors, not from anybody who knew him, not from family members, not from people in England, but guess where? The Southern Poverty Law Center in America. I smell a rat. I smell a big rat. Every time the Southern Poverty Law Center gets in here and starts screaming about right-wing white supremacists, okay, you can bet they're stoking this with a bunch of lies. Details are slowly starting to emerge about a man who had interests in white supremacy and apartheid. He bought material, that says the Southern Poverty Law Center, from a white supremacist group in the United States. That is not the picture that emerges from the people who knew him. As I mentioned before, a 65-year-old neighbor said, well, it's a total surprise he'd be capable of thought, let alone action, she said of her longtime neighbor. They said he never raised his voice. He taught English. He volunteered to teach English to foreigners. He had a black half-brother. Doesn't sound like a white supremacist to me. They all said he had no political beliefs whatsoever, as far as they knew. They said he's very meek and mild. He spoke rationally. He just did his day-to-day routines. They said, and here's the key, he was an immaculate gardener. He often tended to neighbors' gardens as well. Other neighbors gave similar accounts, saying he was a quiet, tidy, often helped with their gardening. 6 years ago, he gave an interview because they were talking about a program where they were helping people who had been at a day center for adults with mental health problems. They got them jobs in the park, and he said, volunteer work has done me more good than all the psychotherapy and medication in the world. Many people who suffer from mental illness and socially isolated, disconnected from society, feeling worthless, are also common, mainly caused by long-term unemployment. This is the passive guy they're now telling you did this wild attack. What changed him? Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and I want to continue with what we were talking about, this shooting in England, this man who seems to be this docile, not all their mental patient, who just said he loved to work in gardens. They were saying West Yorkshire police said they'd seized a number of weapons, including a firearm, shortly after the attack from his apartment here. We've got the Southern Poverty Law Center telling us that he was getting white supremacist hate literature from the United States. And yet the neighbors are painting a picture of a guy who was completely harmless, a man who was a part-time volunteer to teach English to foreigners, a man who had a half-brother who says, by the way, he had never seen any sign that Mayer had any kind of interest in guns or knives. His neighbor said he had no interest in politics. And then when they ask his brother if he was racist, his half-black half-brother says, no chance. He says he's never been in trouble. He wouldn't hurt a fly. And again, remember, 6 years ago, he was saying, I just love to work in gardens. They are just, they do me more good than all the psychotherapy and medication in the world. This is the portrait of a patsy. Who got a hold of this guy? Who put all these knives and guns in his apartment that nobody else had seen? Who is creating this narrative that he is a dangerous white supremacist, racist, highly charged political person who did this for completely political reasons? That's the way it's being spun. That's the way this tragedy is being spun. I mean, who wound this guy up? When I saw this, they're talking about how he kept an immaculate garden and he often tended to other neighbors' gardens as well. Do you remember the movie back in 1979, Being There? Peter Sellers, Shirley MacLaine, Chance the Gardener. You know, they go to this house. He was kind of a gardener and butler for a very wealthy man who died, and he just kept doing it. He was this clueless guy, you know, kind of living like James Holmes is now, the Aurora, Colorado shooter. And but he was out doing the gardening dressed as a butler, and they come up and they talk to him. They didn't really know that he was the gardener. And he says, oh, I'm Chance the Gardener. And they go, Chance the Gardener. Oh, okay. And so all these people who are the most powerful politicians and businessmen, they're coming here to see him, and they ask him these questions, and he is absolutely, totally clueless about what they're talking about. And he answers with these non sequiturs. And at first, they're kind of taken back, and they think, wow. And they read into what he has to say, these non-responses to what they're saying. They read all kinds of deep philosophical meaning in it. Let's play a little bit of clip about that. And they think he's this guru. Let's play a little clip from that trailer.
I'm Chance, the gardener.
The gardener?
Yes. Since I was a child, I worked in this garden.
Then you really are a gardener?
Oh, yes.
May I ask your name?
But they don't really believe he's a gardener. They imply all of these motives to him, and he's this
Mr. Chancey Gardner,
totally disconnected guy like the shooter in the UK.
No, I'm not related to Basil and Perdita.
Gobbledygook.
And there's a black lady who worked with him at the house, and when they put him on television as this guru, she's saying, he's an idiot. He doesn't know anything. Portray him as something. Has got no brains at all.
With rice pudding between the ears.
On television, Mr. President, you look much smaller.
Dumb as a jackass.
That's like, and it goes on and on like this. He gets to the president. He goes on television. He becomes a close advisor to all these captains of industry and political figures. And they're just continue to read into this man what they want to read into him. Now, they're not doing that in a way with this guy. But this guy is just this passive individual that has been a tool, a patsy of the elite. He's not fooling the elite. The elite are using him to fool you. They're using him to forward their agenda. That's what I truly believe. Very, very funny movie. And I'm not making light of the tragedy. Yes, this lady was brutally murdered. You don't know what turned Chance the Gardener into the Joker. I mean, you know, this people should be asking that question, just as they should be asking the question, what turned James Holmes into this vegetable with a Joker wig? You know, what wigged him out? What changed this guy, who was one of the brightest researchers in the country? What changed him into this catatonic Joker? Where did he get all of this equipment to do this? Nobody's asking about that transformation. Nobody is asking about this transformation of this guy, Tommy Mayer, who I will now call Chance the Gardener. Nobody's asking about that. Nobody thinks it's suspicious that it happened exactly 1 week before the vote. And of course, nothing will be talked about except the not only the tragic side of the loss with this, but portraying it as racism. Southern Poverty Law Center, always there. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to talk about terror watch lists. What's behind that? Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We're going to talk about some breaking news as well as what's going on with the terror watch list. What do you need to watch about this terror watch list? I think it is the most dangerous thing that is being proposed. It's not just that it's coming against our Second Amendment. It's not just that it's going to be an infringement of our fundamental rights, another effort to change them into privileges. But we are going into these different devices. We are taking away all due process, and we're moving rapidly towards tools and devices and mechanisms on the part of the government that are the hallmarks of tyranny throughout history. Before we get to that, I want to tell you that we've got a sale right now. You've seen Tim Kennedy on talking about how certain products that he has used at InfoWarsLife.com, how valuable they were to him and his workout, how they gave him a boost. And we've got some of his favorite products here, Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, Secret 12. We have them all as part of a Tim Kennedy special. Of course, he's Special Forces operator, still in Special Forces. He's a UFC fighter, famous in his own right as a fighter, but he is a professional athlete. And so he knows what gets his body going. He's very much in tune to his body, more so than most people are. And he had this run through the Sporting Association, had them check it to make sure it wasn't going to violate any rules. They said, yeah, safe. And he's telling us it's also effective. And so we've got some of his favorite supplements, Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, Secret 12, 15% off at InfoWarsLife.com. These are the products Tim Kennedy uses in his Special Forces and UFC training that help him get to the next level. We also have 20% off of Alexa Pure water filters. And this is all water filters. This isn't just the big water filter units. It's also even the smaller ones like the shower head units. Everything that's a water filter from Alexa Pure right now, 20% off at InfoWarsStore.com. You know, not only do you need to filter out the water that you drink, but even the water that you shower with. If you're in the city and they're putting in chlorine, look at the effects of chlorine when you heat it up and spray it out of the shower heads. That's why a lot of people will get a shower filter to keep from breathing the chlorine that is coming out of the shower. So all the products that are water filters from Alexa Pure, from the super high-quality gravity-fed Alexa Pure Pro water filtration systems all the way down to the shower filters, they're all 20% off right now at InfoWarsStore.com. Okay, some of the news today, we've got Marco Rubio says he is now going to run for re-election to the Senate. Interesting, he's back. Just when you thought he was gone for good, he's back. And as we see also, Sanders, who said he was staying in to the very end so that he could have some leverage at the convention. There's a report up on Politico that he is losing his leverage. As every day goes by, he's becoming more and more yesterday's story. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens at the Democrat convention, if anything happens, or will Hillary have a complete lock? Now, along those lines, we have said all along that not only was the process rigged in the way that most people can plainly see, she started out with, you know, 15% of the way she needed to be towards the finish line with the superdelegates. The whole process is rigged in that way, very openly, very openly. But because of all of these superdelegates, and about 15% of them, 10 to 15% in each state were reserved for superdelegates, the delegates that were going to go to the convention, that meant that he would have to beat her by 10 or 15% in order to get the same number of delegates, because the Democrat Party makes every state a proportional allocation of delegates. So it's not a winner-take-all anywhere. So even if he beat her, and even if he beat her by 10 to 15 points, they wound up getting the same number of delegates. Anytime she beat him, it was a skunk, because she would get whatever edge she had plus the 10 or 15 percent of the delegates that were already there. But of course, there's other ways that they rigged the election as well. And this is what we have to be concerned about when we come to the fall. And I talked about this back when we had the Utah primary. I thought it was kind of suspicious that the GOP had gone out and paid $80,000 in Utah to bring in Smartmatic. Now, this is the largest electronic voting machine company in the world. But it is also a voting machine company that has, I would say, the longest rap sheet in the world. Smartmatic started in Venezuela by some friends of Hugo Chavez. And they were involved in election after election that American officials said were being rigged by Hugo Chavez. And then they started selling their machines elsewhere throughout Central and South America, as well as the Philippines. And And there is a long list from the Philippines to the Tabasco region in Mexico to Brazil to other Central and South American countries where people have said, hey, you know, something is wrong. Something is wrong. The voting machines go down. All of a sudden, 25% of the votes are just gone, and there's no audit trail with these machines. They just disappeared. How about that? Would you like to have an election where 25% of the votes, millions, tens of millions of votes just disappear? Well, that's already happened in some countries. And the more we put these electronic machines here, the more that's going to happen in America. And it will happen in America. In Brazil, where there is the currently the struggle for power that's going on there with a very, very unpopular female socialist president. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? She was roundly booed just before the election at a soccer event. She was down 10 points in the poll, and yet she suddenly won by 10 points or so on the re-election. And the interesting thing about that was that they didn't do any exit polls, because exit polls are one of the indications when you have somebody that is losing an election before, and they are maybe losing in the election afterwards by exit polls, but then the official polls say, hey, they won by a large margin. Everybody knows there was fraud involved. And so they shut that down. And the company that always did that for Brazil, that always did the exit polls for Brazil, just decided they weren't going to do them for that particular election. And then they got tens of millions of dollars in contracts from the Brazilian government afterwards. Looked like payola. Now, why am I going into this history of this? Well, because we've got an organization here. This is a report from DC Clothesline. A racketeering lawsuit exposing nationwide vote rigging and DNC primaries could derail Clinton, they say. This is a major lawsuit. It's on the verge of being filed by the Institute for American Democracy and Election Integrity. They were going to file it last week, but they said, no, we want to wait and get the results from California, because that was very important, and we think there may have been fraud there. They're going to take a look at that first, get that information, and possibly include that in the lawsuit. The group claims that in about 11 states, there has been a noted significant difference between exit polls and the electronic vote totals presented in the mornings after the primaries. These differences show votes appear to be shifted from Bernie Sanders to Hillary Clinton. You think they'd do that? And so we see, when we look at, they've got a table here, and they're showing the margin between them and the exit polls and the discrepancies in favor of Clinton versus the other polls that were there. And the interesting thing about this, of course, is that when you look at the margin, what is statistically significant? Well, they say that the U.S. government itself says that if there's more than a 2% difference between the official election polls and the exit polls, that is the boundary by which the U.S. government determines whether an election in another country has probably been stolen. And notice that the exit polls in these 11 states, they say, 2016 DNC primaries, they were significantly more than a 2% difference. One of them was, I think it was, over 10% difference, okay, there. They say this is not a Republican-Democrat issue. This is not a partisan issue. This is an issue of democracy, or I should say integrity. We need to have honest elections. And there's a number of ways that the elections can be stolen. They can be stolen by superdelegates, by the other processes. They can be stolen by having illegitimate voters. They can be stolen by stuffing the electronic ballot machines. That's one of the easiest ways to steal the elections. The easiest way is by electronic means. They say Richard Sharnan, a mathematician, statistician, author of the book Matrix of Deceit, has been reporting on the apparent shifting of electronic vote totals and the non-release of raw data from Edison polling research, okay? I'll tell you who they are in just a moment, since 2004. So he's been looking at this for 12 years. He's well known for what he calls the red shift. He says it's been a shift between exit polls and electronic vote totals, a difference of about 4 to 5% each year. And this constitutes a shift to the political right. You understand? This is not about left and right. It's not about Democrat, Republican. This is about corruption. And this is about rigging electronic voting machines and how easy it is to do it. And this guy who's been researching it for 12 years says typically it's a red shift. Typically it's a shift towards the red candidates, okay? And I hate the fact that they do that, because red really has always been the color of communism. That's deliberately why they reversed that on you, by the way. Deliberately why they did that. But It's been a shift towards the right, let's just put it that way, or conservatives of about 4 to 5% each year. Very suspicious. But now what they saw in the primaries was a massive shift for Hillary Clinton. Now, the same people who are rigging this system for the GOP, if that's what's been going on, do you think that they could possibly rig this to make sure that Hillary Clinton wins? Because we've already got Ted Cruz meeting with GOP conservatives in a secret meeting reported by The Hill, saying, yeah, we're planning to see what happens in the next election. You know, they're hoping that Donald Trump is going to lose because they're opposed to him because he opposes their globalist agenda of open borders, of trade treaties that were written by the corporations, of continual foreign wars. He opposes all of that. And so for those reasons alone, he must be stopped. Those are the vital issues to the establishment in both the Republican and the Democrat Party. That's why the establishment in both the Republican and the Democrat Party want to see Hillary Clinton win this election. And that's why these people who have control and can flip the levers in these electronic voting machines, they've been shifting it to the conservatives. You think they might shift it to Hillary Clinton so then they can run against her 4 years from now? Doesn't matter. It isn't even about them beating Hillary Clinton 4 years from now. It's about them getting their agenda through, Paul Ryan and others, Mitch McConnell and others. They want the open borders. They want these transatlantic trade agreements. That has to be run through as far as they're concerned. They have to have this globalism, this consolidation. Now, who are these people? This is kind of interesting. You know, when you look at the exit polls, I mentioned that in Brazil, after that dramatic reversal, that one-day reversal in the official election polls, remember the Brazilian president was down like 10%. And then, after that, she's still very unpopular. They're trying to impeach her. And immediately after that, she was very unpopular. But for that particular day, with the official results, she won about 10%. How did that happen? And again, the exit polling company didn't do any exit polls. Now, we have an exit polling company here in America. It's called Edison Research Polling. You may not have known this, but they run all of the exit polling throughout the country. Since 1996, they run it as part of a pool. You know, they have these press pools. So when you go to cover a political event, in many cases, they don't let every single news organization into the event. They will have a press pool camera. It would just get too crowded. So what they will do is I have people who are part of the press pool. You will all get the feed from this one camera that's there instead of everybody having their own camera. So there's that kind of pooling that goes on with the press. Well, for the election polls, they have the National Election Pool. And this company, Edison Research, has, since 1996, provided all of the election polling, all the exit polling for ABC, NBC, CBS, the big three. In addition, CNN, Fox, AP, they all belong to this National Election Pool. And they all get their information from Edison Research Polling. Now, it's interesting, isn't it, that I don't recall, and I follow politics pretty closely, but I don't ever recall ever seeing any of these organizations that are part of the election pool that get this information from Edison Research. I don't ever recall seeing them publicize the kind of numbers that this organization, the Institute for American Democracy, they've got the numbers of the exit poll, and they're using it as the basis for their lawsuit saying that Hillary Clinton and the DNC rigged the primaries against Bernie Sanders. But you've never seen these numbers that they've got here. They don't publicize those on ABC, NBC, CBS, CNN, Fox, and AP. What you will see is you'll see cross tabulations of demographics. They'll come out and they'll say, well, you know, the majority, this many of the women voted for candidate X, and this many of the men voted for candidate Y, and they'll break it down by age group. They'll break it down by income. They'll break it down by, oh, of course, race, okay? Religion sometimes, okay? They'll break it down with all these different cross tabulations of the demographics, but they won't come out and say, well, according to the exit polls, Hillary got this many and Bernie got that many. You'll never see that. You'll never see the grand total because that would look kind of bad, wouldn't it? If that number doesn't agree and if it's radically different, way outside the margin of error of the regular polls, people would start to smell a rat, wouldn't they? So they don't report that information, do they? No. And so I hope that this lawsuit goes somewhere. I think that is very important. Again, they are waiting to get the crosstab results out of California to take a look at that. That's what we have to be concerned about in the general election, that it'll be stolen. That it'll be stolen, and it will be a joint effort by the Republican and by the Democrat establishment, who do not want to see a populist nationalist movement against their globalist trade treaties and open borders. That's what we have to be concerned about. Now, what's going on with the gun control agenda that they're putting on? And as I've said before, in the aftermath of what happened, and we see all these efforts to shut down anyone who tries to say that what motivated this guy was Islam. Of course it motivated him. He was a homosexual. He had nothing to do with his guilt except to try to punish other people. He had no cross, okay? So he crucified everybody else. And it was his religion that motivated that. My wife has a friend from college, and she still follows people on Facebook. I don't do anything with Facebook. I hate that social media rigging. But anyway, she follows people that we used to know. And this friend of hers who teaches high school put up a thing on Facebook. I don't want to hear anything about Islam or Muslims. I don't even want to hear it. I don't even talk about that. This is a time to warn the gays. Oh, we don't want to talk about what actually motivated him to do this. We don't want to talk about the anger and the hatred and the religion that caused that. We don't want to talk about the open borders. We don't want to talk about the fact that Obama has gone in and has created all of this unrest in all these countries, as American government, not just Obama, but of course the Republicans before him. They create the wars, and then we reap the whirlwind from it, okay? Before I get into that, while I'm on this topic, let me go to this. Free Thought Project talks about the results of the Afghanistan and Iraq war. They say in spite of the trillions that have been wasted and the thousands dead, there are more Taliban in Afghanistan than there were before 2001. Oh, and with us there, there's a lot more heroin that's being grown out of that region too. That's another thing, okay? But they talk about how we have essentially created this problem. It's not Donald Trump saying we're not going to let these people in. Maybe it's us killing them. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're about to come to the close of our regular broadcast, but in the fourth hour, we're going to talk about what's going on with the watch list. You wouldn't believe that there are people who don't like guns that are more afraid of the watch list, and we're going to tell you how that works out when we come back in the fourth hour of the broadcast today. Before we go to these clips from Leon Panetta, I just want to remind you, we have a special, a Tim Kennedy special, 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12. And of course, Tim Kennedy, UFC fighter, special forces operator, someone who is in touch with his body. He trains intensively, and he's talked with Alex about how much he can feel the difference when he uses these particular products, especially. We put them on sale, 15% off the Tim Kennedy special. You can find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, I've got a couple of clips that I want to play, and I'm going to go through these real quick, play them back to back. First of all, the talking points that are coming out from Joe Behar at The View, as well as former CIA head, former Secretary of Defense, former congressman, full-time scumbag, Leon Panetta. Here's what he had to say about Donald Trump.
I wanted to get your reaction to what Donald Trump said this week, which seemed to suggest somehow that the President of the United States was complicit or involved in a conspiracy or looking the other way. This was Trump on the air on Monday with Savannah Guthrie on Today.
You said about the president, he doesn't get it or he gets it better than anybody understands. What do you mean by that?
Well, there are a lot of people that think maybe he doesn't want to get it. A lot of people think maybe he doesn't want to know about it. I happen to think that he just doesn't know what he's doing. But there are many people that think maybe he doesn't want to get it. He doesn't want to see what's really happening. Why?
Now, I know you have endorsed Hillary Clinton, but if you could take a step back, if that's possible, and react to Donald Trump's suggestions about the President of the United States.
Leon Panetta.
Well, I have to tell you, in 50 years of public life, I have never experienced a major party candidate making the accusations and raising the innuendos that Donald Trump raised, particularly at this moment of crisis. My experience is when this country has been attacked, that this country comes together and unifies and tries to build a consensus about how we protect ourselves in the future. What Trump is doing is the exact opposite. He's not only accusing President of the United States of treason and collaborating with the enemy, but in many ways, what he's saying about restricting Muslims from coming into this country, doing surveillance on Muslim mosques, is basically aiding and abetting the enemy.
Okay, let me jump in at this point because we're running out of time here. We don't have time to play the other clip in this segment. I wanted to define for you who this guy was. Jeff Sessions encountered him a few years ago, asking him when he became Secretary of Defense, so what would be the grounds on which we would go to war? You would come to Congress and act, right? And he says, no, we would talk to the actually, he was talking about how they would go to the UN, they would go to the to NATO to get permission. And he goes, but you would ask Congress, well, nah, probably not. But we would probably tell you what we decide to do at some point. And Sessions was absolutely incredulous. So we're going to play that clip for you when we come back. But I got to say, he's accusing the president of actually aiding the enemy. That is a known fact. It is a documented fact that we are giving arms to ISIS. We're running them through Turkey. We have documented this over and over again. And not just us. Many media outlets have documented the fact that we are supplying them with arms. Going all the way back through Republicans and Democrats to the Mujahideen in Afghanistan fighting the Russians. We created them. We gave them the Stinger missiles. Then we turned them into Al-Qaeda. Then we turned them into ISIS. We created the terrorist playground in Libya. The Democrat administration, the Obama administration with Secretary Clinton, turned that place into total chaos. They're trying to do it in Syria. That's what he's talking about. Let me make that clear for you. We'll do that when we come back. Stay with us. Welcome back to the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We're going to be joined at the bottom of the hour with Rob Due because we really want to expand this coverage of the terror watch list. And what is really, you should be concerned about this, folks. This is a very, very dangerous thing. We're going to break that down for you. We're going to talk about all the kids that are being put on the terror watch list, as well as the other abuses that are possible with this secret process. But we were talking in the last segment about Leon Panetta, and he's attacking Trump. And he's coming out and saying, well, he's not only accusing the President of the United States of treason and collaborating with the enemy, but what he's saying about restricting Muslims is going to get them mad and they're going to attack us. And we've heard that before, haven't we? You know, I mean, do we really want to bring people into this country? Is that an argument for bringing people in this country saying, you know what, if we don't kowtow to them, they're going to get violent with us? It's like, well, then maybe what we ought to do is just leave them where they are. We have always helped people in the past when there's been a natural disaster in their country. Now, our foreign aid doesn't really work too well. Most of the time, it gets sucked up by the dictators in these countries. They wind up taking the food from the people's mouths, but they do that anyway. And we really cannot bring people from all over the world into the United States without any background checks. I mean, all these people who are screaming about gun control, saying, background checks, background checks. The guy who was a shooter in Orlando had been vetted by the world's largest private security company. He had worked for them for 8 years. He had been vetted by the state of Florida, had a statewide firearms license and many other issues. He had been investigated 3 times by the FBI. He had been on the terror watch list, and they hadn't done anything about that. His company worked for Homeland Security. So you got Homeland Security, the FBI, the state government of Florida, as well as the world's largest private security firm. Nobody saw anything in his background to stop it. Are we vetting people who are coming into this country that carefully, that closely? Of course not. We don't know a fraction about them that we do about him. And if there's refugees, wouldn't you think it'd be fairly evenly distributed between men, women, and children? Wouldn't it be distributed between all different kinds of ages? Why is it that we're only getting as refugees young men in their 20s and 30s who you would think would be fighting the people who are destroying their country instead of running out, okay? At the very least, they're shoving everybody aside and jumping on the lifeboats themselves. Those are the people we're bringing in into this country. Where are the background checks for them? Where's the watch list for them? No. All the controls are for you, Americans. We've been told by Jay Johnson, Homeland Security, yes, this is a national security issue. Gun control is now going to become a national security issue, and we're really more concerned about those right-wingers than we are Islamic extremists. Of course they are. We've pointed that out a long time. So you've got Leon Panetta saying that Donald Trump is triggering people. Okay, now we'll talk about triggering in a minute, but let's play. I want to introduce, who is this guy? Who is this former CIA? Who is this former Secretary of Defense? Here's an exchange between Jeff Sessions and Leon Panetta a few years ago.
We're working with an international coalition, and we're working with NATO.
Jeff Sessions.
Want to be able to get appropriate permissions in order to be able to do that. That's,
you'd ask him, what's the basis on which you're going to send people to war?
All countries would want to have some kind of legal basis on which to act.
What legal basis are you looking for? What entity?
To go to war.
Well, obviously, if NATO made the decision to go in, that would be one. If we developed an international coalition beyond NATO, then obviously some kind of UN security resolution would be the basis
for that. Coalition of, so you're saying NATO would give you a legal basis? And
this is Jeff Sessions.
Coalition of
this
nations
is the guy who's been advising Donald Trump.
Provide a legal basis.
He can't believe what he's hearing.
If we were able to put together a coalition, were able to move together, then obviously we would seek whatever legal basis we would need in order to make that justified. I mean, you know, we can't just pull them all together in a combat.
So he needs the support of NATO and the UN to go to war, not Congress.
Who are you asking for the legal basis from?
If it's obviously, if the UN passed a security resolution as it did in Libya, we would do that.
And they just keep going back and forth. And finally, Senator Sessions says, I can't believe what I'm hearing. You're a congressman. All right, welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Friday, June 17th, 2016. I want to finish that clip that we were playing in the last segment of Senator Sessions and Leon Panetta talking about what is the basis for war anymore. Do you have a constitution? Well, according to Leon Panetta, no. And Senator Sessions cannot believe his ears. I mean, even with all the years that he's spent in Washington, he can't believe it. And I want to play that because this is a guy, Leon Panetta, who is out there saying, well, you know, Donald Trump is going to trigger Muslims. He is recruiting people for ISIS because he's saying we're going to vet people coming into the country. And at the same time, these same people are saying, we got to have more background checks. We got to have more watch lists for people, for Americans, not for the people coming from the countries that we are currently bombing. No, the bombs and the assassinations and the wars that we've started in their countries, that doesn't trigger them at all. No, what triggers them is saying, we're going to investigate your background before you come in or you're not going to come in. That triggers them. That triggers them. We should be aware of that. We should be scared of them doing that. It's Donald Trump's fault, okay? Before we get back to that clip, I just want to let you know we've got a couple of specials. We've got the Alexa Pure Water Filter special, which is still going on. It's going to be for a limited time only. So look at that now while it's available at InfoWarsStore.com. 20% off all the Alexa Pure Water Filters. That's from everything from the super high-quality gravity-fed Alexa Pure Pro Water Filtration System all the way down to the smaller shower filters. All of these items are 20% off. Now is the time to stock up. Get the lowest prices. The Alexa Pure filtration system removes up to 99.9999% of bacteria, disinfectants, volatile organic contaminants, and hormones. So whether you're on a well or whether you are on a city water supply, this is an excellent filter to have. And again, 20% off everything from the biggest systems down to the shower filters that will filter out the chlorine that's coming through your urban water supply. Going back to this clip, I want to go back and play a little bit of this. Maybe you might want to back this up a little bit. This is a back and forth. You've got Senator Sessions asking, now this guy, Leon Panetta, he has been a congressman. Then he became Secretary of Defense. Then he became CIA director. I think that was the order. I think that's the last thing he did was CIA director. Under Obama from 2009 to 2011, says the article on InfoWars. But this was when he was Secretary of Defense. And we had Senator Sessions saying to him, under what conditions would you go to war? And he starts talking about how they're going to get approval, try to get a coalition together at the UN or with NATO or whatever. And he goes, yeah, but who are you going to ask permission? He's kind of leading him along. And let's go back to that clip.
Asking for the legal basis from.
If it's, obviously, if the UN passed a security resolution as it did in Libya, we would do that. If NATO came together as we did in Bosnia, we would rely on that. So, you know, we have options here. if we want to build the kind of international approach to dealing with the situation.
Well, I'm for all for having an international support, but I'm really baffled.
That's
by
all
the
really
idea
nice, but
that somehow an international assembly provides a legal basis for the United States military to be deployed in combat. I don't believe it's close to being correct. They can provide no legal authority. The only legal authority that's required to deploy the United States military is the Congress and the President and the law and the Constitution.
Jeff Sessions for Vice President. This guy believes the Constitution. He's absolutely incredulous with Leon Panetta at one point. We let this go on. He goes, I can't believe what I'm hearing, because they go back and forth. And Leon Panetta, after he lectures him on the Constitution, Leon Panetta says, yeah, we would let the Congress know, but we're not going to go to them for authority. We will go to a foreign body for authority, or we'll make the determination on our own. But we're not going to go to Congress for a declaration of war. Not going to do that. And Senator Sessions says, I can't believe this. You were a congressman. You know what the Constitution says. You swore an oath to the Constitution. Senator Sessions takes this very seriously. He takes his oath of office seriously. He takes the oath of the Constitution seriously. This is the only, that Senator Sessions, who challenged this practice that has been a bipartisan practice of we'll do whatever we want anywhere in the world. We'll go to war with anybody. We won't ask the representatives of the American people according to the Constitution to get a declaration of war. He takes it seriously, and he was the only person when they finally made these private trade treaties, the Trans-Pacific, Transatlantic treaties, when they finally made them available to our elected representatives, Senator Sessions was the only one who went down and read them. And he was amazed. He was just as appalled as he was with this clip where you saw him going back and forth with this globalist shill, Leon Panetta, CIA director, Secretary of Defense. And he said he put together a presentation for his fellow senators and said, look at what we're about to pass. Look at this thing that we're throwing away the procedure to ratify a treaty. The procedure to ratify a treaty is 2/3 of the Senate. We're saying we're not going to do that. We're going to have a trade promotion authority that we're going to do. It's just a simple majority, because they didn't have a 2/3 majority of the Senate to support this. So I said, well, okay, we don't have the vote, so let's just invent some new process that doesn't have anything to do with the Constitution. We'll call it the TPA, and we'll say senators can't have a filibuster. Senators and the House can't offer any amendments to it. Yeah, we'll let the House vote on it too, but it'll just be a simple majority. Nobody can offer any amendments. Nobody can have any filibusters. And they're going to have to vote on it with just 20 hours of talking about it. And you're not going to be able to block it from coming up to a vote in either the House or the Senate. So they just greased this whole thing through. And he said, look, understand, there's a lot of problems with this. He laid out the problems, and he said, the biggest problem is once you pass this agreement, it becomes a living document. You have no control over what happens to the trade in your country anymore after that. They're going to have this international commission that will sit there and make determinations as to which industries and which countries will be rewarded, which industries and which countries will be punished. This will be made in determination by unelected people at an international council. That's what Senator Sessions was telling him. Senator Sessions has been telling this to Donald Trump since last August. He started educating him about the TPP. And now his former chief of staff is now the foreign policy chief of staff for Donald Trump. I hope that Donald Trump picks somebody that is a principled, constitutional conservative like Senator Jeff Sessions. Let's hope that happens. Now, what is really happening with this? I mean, is it really Donald Trump's fault that ISIS is getting upset? Or is our president really giving them the weapons? Of course, our president's giving them the weapons. As I pointed out, we've documented this many times, but let's just step back for a moment and let's look at the history of what's happened in Afghanistan and Iraq with those wars. The Free Thought Project says, in spite of trillions wasted, thousands dead, there are now more Taliban in Afghanistan than there were before 2001. More than 2,300 of our troops are dead. Tens of thousands more mangled and traumatized. More than 11,000 innocent women and children turned into casualties. Tens of thousands of other lives ruined, permanently ended. And there's nothing to show for it. There are more Taliban controlling the region now than before Bush's assault on the country 15 years ago. Aside from the countless ruined lives, the cost of the war has reached astronomical cash proportions. Mountains of debt for us, for our children, for our great-grandchildren. The Congressional Research Service has pointed out that the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq have cost U.S. taxpayers $1.6 trillion. What other things could we have bought with that other than massive death? However, according to the report from Time magazine last year, that number is a gross underestimate. They say a truer measure of the war's total cost would be between $4 and $5 trillion, because what they do is they factor in things like long-term medical care and disability compensation for service members, veterans, their families, military replenishment, social and economic costs. Oh, see, that military replenishment, that's when the military-industrial complex gets to sell more bombs to us after we've used those bombs. See, that's replenishment. That's why they make so much money out of these wars. They say occupying a foreign country creates enemies. You think? Yeah. That's what creates enemies. It isn't by saying we're going to restrict immigration from a country and all of a sudden they're going to attack us for that. No, they attack us because we are killing them. And it's not having any results. Nation building is a failed strategy from the beginning. We can't force democracy and self-government on people that don't want it, don't understand it. They have a system closely tied to their religion of totalitarianism. It's called Sharia law. Look at it. And what they point out here, this is a great headline. They were planting a garden in which a million bin Ladens would later bloom. Think about that. Our policy throughout the Middle East has been planting a garden where a million bin Ladens would later bloom. Bin Laden being the establishment metaphor meme for terrorism, okay? But it's real. There is real terrorism. And not only did they create the garden to let terrorism bloom, but they are now importing the fruits of that war into our country, that anger, that frustration, that hatred. And it will only build and get worse with the second generation. That is what we're seeing everywhere. We saw that in France. We saw that with the shooting in Orlando. It is the second generation that is always worse. It's the second generation that doesn't even understand what they escaped from, is looking for an identity, is angry at America because they've been propagandized by the American educational system that is teaching everyone to hate the principles of America, to hate the people who founded this country, to hate people based on their race, hate white people, hate males, hate all of this. Find your identity and wherever it was that your parents came from and attack the roots of America. That's what our foreign policy is about. That's what our immigration policy is about. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In the next segment, we're going to have Rob Due and Leanne McAdoo join me. We're going to be talking about the watch list and other issues about gun control. I guess we'll have the team of Due and McAdoo coming in here. So let me start this off by catching you up on current events. We had yesterday the end of a filibuster by Democrats to try to bring to the table legislation that would tie these secret watch lists to gun control. It would be basically a no-buy list for people who were put on this watch list. Now, is this going to pass? Well, NPR says they think that it's unlikely. They're going to vote on four gun control measures Monday evening. NPR doesn't think any of those are going to go through. We got an article from Kurt Nimmo at Infowars.com. Passage of Democrat gun bill violating our due process is unlikely in the Senate. He says it's uncertain if Feinstein's bill and competing legislation sponsored by Senator John Cornyn of Texas will receive the 60 votes required unless a deal is reached. Feinstein's legislation would permit the federal government to deny individuals on a secret terrorist watch list the right to exercise the Second Amendment if authorities decide there's a reasonable belief that the weapon could be used in connection with terrorism. Cornyn said negotiations in the Senate failed because Feinstein thought due process of law and the Constitution were not necessary. So Cornyn's version of legislation would keep constitutional protections in place. It would allow the government to put a gun purchase on hold for 72 hours. Prosecutors would then be able to convince a judge that there was probable cause in order to permanently block a sale. See, what's happening with this is there's a lot of pressure. We got people like Piers Morgan coming after Donald Trump and doing an editorial immediately after the shooting saying, come on, Donald, come on, NRA. It's time you guys gave up some of your freedoms. We have to do something about this shooting. And they're listening. The NRA and Donald Trump have tweeted out that they're going to talk about doing something in the interest of national security about this terrorist watch list. And that should concern us all. Because what we're seeing now is a movement by both the left and the right to enact new gun control laws. This effort that we have here by John Cornyn with all of the bluster about how we're going to have due process and everything, process is a bunch of nonsense. Because quite frankly, if somebody is on a terror watch list, we should be asking what that is. I want to go back to an article here that goes back to December of this last December 2015. The LA Times, not exactly a Second Amendment publication, folks. These are people who don't like the Second Amendment. They say, should people on the no-fly list be able to buy guns? They said, yes. Because you know what? If you don't do that, you're going to be punishing people before you give them due process. You know, you have a secret list that you're creating. And then you're going to, on the basis of that secret list, you're going to punish people. They say it seems simple enough. If the federal government, based on intelligence or on policing, puts a person on its watch list of suspected terrorists or decrees that he or she is too dangerous to be allowed on an airplane, then surely it would also be foolish to let that person buy a firearm in the U.S. It makes sense, doesn't it? Because that's the argument we've heard over and over again from Imam Obama. He says that was a thrust of a proposed law by Senator Dianne Feinstein that her Senate colleagues rejected last week. The idea was resuscitated by Imam Obama in his Oval Office address on that Sunday evening. He said, what could possibly be the argument for allowing a terrorist suspect to buy a semi-automatic weapon? They said the problem is the people on the no-fly list, as well as the people who are on the broader terror watch list from which it's drawn, have not been convicted of doing anything wrong. See, the punishment doesn't fit the crime. The punishment precedes the crime. We are combining the worst aspects of our most dystopian science fiction all together here in one place. We've got elements of George Orwell. We've got elements of Franz Kafka. We've got elements of Philip K. Dick and his Minority Report pre-crime. All these things are being brought together in a hellish tyranny that's going to be controlled by a government that watches and controls your every move. Don't think that they're not going to use these watch lists to deny you complete movement in this country. The TSA is the Transportation Administration, okay? Not the Airport Administration. Security, safety, whatever the S stands for. I could care less. It's a total lie. It's a total fraud. They're not providing security or safety for anybody. And it is about transportation. And they're going to be taking control of the automobiles. Everything in the next few years with technology. So they're going to be able to shut you down completely, not just control whether or not you get firearms. We have to be focused on the watch list. We have to watch the watchers. Why are they putting people on this list? How do you get on it? How do you get off? Where's the due process? Where is the Constitution? When we come back, we're going to be joined by Dew and McAdoo, and we're going to talk about these watch lists. We're watching. Stay with us. Watch us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host, and joining me right now are Rob Dew and Leanne McAdoo. We're going to talk about these super secret watch lists and what you should be afraid of. Before we get to that discussion, real quickly, I want to remind you of the sales that we have at InfoWars.com. We have 20% off all Alexa Pure water filters at InfoWarsStore.com. That includes everything from our large systems, a super high-quality gravity-fed Alexa Pure Pro water filtration system all the way down to the shower filters. All of the Alexa Pure water filter products are 20% off right now at InfoWarsStore.com. Also, we have a new special, the Tim Kennedy special, and that's 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com. Why those three products? Well, those are three products that Tim Kennedy uses in his Special Forces and UFC training. He trains like a top flight professional athlete, because with just UFC, he is a top flight professional athlete. But of course, he's also in Special Forces. He said that these products he felt were especially helpful. He's talked to Alex about that. We've got hundreds of five-star reviews on those products. And again, you can get Tim Kennedy's preferences right there, his favorite products, Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12, 15% off right now at InfoWarsLife.com. Well, Rob and Leanne, I got to say, just real quickly before we get back into the watch list stuff, are you aware that the Senate has now approved women having to register for the draft? So now women have equality in slavery.
Wow.
That's part of the NDAA. And of course,
I knew that was coming.
Yeah. It hasn't become law yet because it still has to go to the House. The House has previously rejected women as slaves. And and so now they're going to go back and revisit that issue. But again, I just have to say, my parents' generation, nobody had to hold a gun to anybody's head to get them to join the fight after Pearl Harbor. Mm-hmm. If you've got a justified war, if your country has been attacked or whatever, and I understand the basis of Pearl Harbor, I know that FDR had people step down. I know that to that degree, what was going on. Nevertheless, people who were there, they understood that at that point, they were in it. They were in a fight for their lives, just like we're seeing with the war on terror. You create this situation, and then, you know, once the shooting starts, you know, you got to pick up a gun. And
or once you have the false flag.
Once you got the false flag, you
know,
yeah.
With 9/11.
Yeah.
You know, people can say what they want about it. There's something fishy going on there. But that caused a lot of people, Joe Biggs included, who saw that and said, you know, I want to go fight. And who was the football player, the Arizona Cardinal, who ended up getting killed after he decided, oh, he's like, wait, I'm fighting for the wrong people and for the wrong reasons.
That's right.
And we're running drugs. I forget his name. Pat Tillman.
Yes, exactly. I'm watching Game of Thrones right now, and it's just the same thing over and over and over again, except for back then they could just say, give us all your men in the village and they're going to go fight our war for us. It's the same thing here, but that now they have to find new ways to convince people to go and fight their wars.
That's right. If you've got a clear cause, if it's justified, or even if you've got a good backstory with a false flag, you don't need a draft. But, you know, what we should be very afraid of, is the fact that they are so anxious to
start a war with Russia.
Start a war. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you guys do some computer stuff, and they tell us that it's from Russia. We don't know that it's from Russia. I mean, most of the Aaron Schwartz.
Could be a paid Russian hacker who's really a CIA double agent. You know, it could be any number of things.
That's right.
And that's not even a violent act, although, you know, it leaves too much open ground to start something that the only way to finish it is an all-out war. And that's something I don't think 90% of the people want.
No, nobody wants, but they're really gearing us up for it.
And no real control over it either. If they're just going to tell us, you know, there was this cyber attack, and so now we're going to have a physical war. Let's start World War III because there was a cyber attack here. Let's get to the watch list because this is very key. You know, this is the LA Times that I was reading from, talking about how the problem is, how do you get on the no-fly list? I mean, we're operating from the assumption here, the NRA, let me read you what the NRA is saying here. The NRA statement on terror watch lists, and this is from their legal organization, the Institute for Legislative Action. So this is the NRA, ILA. They say the NRA believes terrorists should not be allowed to purchase or possess firearms, period. Well, who's going to disagree with that? Question is, who is a terrorist? Who gets to define what a terrorist is? And they say, anyone on a terror watch list who tries to buy a gun should be thoroughly investigated by the FBI, and the sale should be delayed while the investigation is ongoing. And that's the legislation that's being offered by Texas Senator Cornyn in opposition to Dianne Feinstein, which just basically say, well, as long as, whatever, we're just going to use it to do gun control. The NRA continues and says, if an investigation uncovers evidence of terrorist activity or involvement, the government should be allowed to immediately go to court, block the sale, and arrest the terrorist. And I look at this and it's like, wait a minute.
And arrest the terrorist.
They've got a lot of
He's
steps.
He's already a terrorist.
There's a lot of steps in due process that they left out here.
Yeah.
And the steps that they've got are in the wrong order. The punishment doesn't come first. And you don't become a terrorist because somebody accuses you secretly and puts you on a secret watch list that you don't know anything about. We've had people like Ted Kennedy put on a terror watch list and told that he was not able to fly. It turned out it was a T. Kennedy, and it took
Mandela.
It took Senator Kennedy 3 weeks to get his name cleared. Now, in that particular case, I would say maybe it was justified.
I would say
that because politically, I don't agree with him. And that's what this is going to become. It's going to become an instrument of political oppression. Okay? Not that I would do that to somebody because I disagree with them politically. I was joking about that, but that's precisely what they will do. We've been told this is about domestic right-wing extremists more than it is about Islamic terrorists. How many times do they have to tell us that? And we were told that again this week by Jay Johnson, Homeland Security.
And Art A. Civito.
Yeah, Arnaz Lavedo, yeah. He's like, hey, let me remind you.
Guys.
Yeah, yeah, they're at a meeting, and our police chief here, you know, they have this meeting, and he's like a little Mr. Brown noser. Oh, let me remind you, Mr.
The
Johnson.
Real problem here.
Yeah, we know who the real people are that we're after.
Shift the narrative back around. Well, it's just like the leaked DNC talking points that we are seeing with showing all the Trump opposition and how they have the timeline for the talking points they're going to use to take out Trump. Well, this is sort of the same thing, because they saw this as their opportunity for the no fly, no buy, and they're really rolling that out as the talking point, even though it would not have stopped this terror attack. It has nothing to do with what happened in Orlando.
In fact, one of the gun shops he went to get bulk ammunition and body armor, level 3 body armor, they notified the FBI.
Mm-hmm.
They
mm-hmm.
did what they were supposed to do. They mm-hmm. said, this seems fishy. Hey, red flag, red flag, red flag. And what happened? FBI obviously did nothing. They sat on it for one reason or another. I don't know. Either they're incompetent or they did it on purpose. I don't know.
You have a worker, a fellow worker with him that alerted the world's largest private security firm and said, hey, this guy's making all kinds of hateful remarks about all these different groups of people. He wants to kill everybody. Oh, you know, we're not going to do anything because he's a Muslim. It would be politically incorrect to do it. Right. So the private security firm, the state government, the federal government, Homeland Security, all these people have had this guy in their crosshairs for the longest period of time and let him go.
But David, now they're going to fix it. Now they can fix it if they could just get the guns, your guns, my guns, and your guns, and everybody who's not a government official, if they can get their guns, it'll solve the problem.
But see, the thing is, we have to be worried about, it's not gun control, but it's border patrol. If a terrorist comes into the country, or if we import them by the tens of thousands like Imam Obama is doing, okay, you're going to have a situation. Yeah, you're going to have a situation. Yeah, that's the headline on Drudge today.
Yep.
We got this Middle Eastern lady that was apprehended at the border that had a pipeline plans. Okay, so if you're a terrorist and you come into this country, do you really want a semi-automatic rifle, or would you rather have a nuclear weapon, a biological weapon, a chemical weapon, or maybe just blow up our infrastructure, the gas infrastructure? I mean, if you let, the problem is somebody who wants to create a crime like that. It isn't the weapon, okay? And that's not going to be the most lethal weapon that they get.
And she was someone on the refugee program.
Yeah.
One apprehended.
There you go.
So, yeah, I mean, these are people that need our help, and we're aiding them in
helping to destroy our country.
Destroy this country.
So I did a quick look. I put children on no-fly list, and it brought up hundreds of articles. I just printed out a few. The first one is Associated Press. Back in 2006, four-year-old turns up on no-fly list. So this is a four-year-old, okay? Then here's Mikey, who they just had on there. Mikey's the Boy Scout, Mikey Hicks. Back in 2010, the U.S. had him on the watch list, the terror watch list, no-fly list. Then we've got... here's an 18-month-old baby yanked from airplane for being on no-fly list.
18-month-old baby.
Like, there's no logic being based
on
what they're doing.
Look at that face. It's little terror.
That, yeah.
There.
Grab that pacifier. Yeah. Take that right out of her mouth, yeah.
TSA detains 5-year-old because his name was on the no-fly list.
So these are these bumbling fools that they're like, well, I don't know, 5-year-old, your name's on the list.
Exactly. And then in 2014, an Oregon judge said, we got to stop this no-fly list. This is ridiculous. And it was a you know, 14 plaintiffs came forward and said, look, you know, we don't know how we get on. We don't know how we get off. He tried to stop it. But here, still 2016, Canadian 6-year-old, still on no-fly list despite government's help. And I did find out how you get on the no-fly list. Check out this criteria. Okay, they don't want to base it. They say they don't base it on anything that includes freedom of speech or exercise of religion or peaceful assembly. But that can be superseded, such as if the individual expresses sympathy toward a group the U.S. government considers to be a terrorist organization, or a student of a school or university that employs professors or other staff who are known to espouse ideologies and beliefs the U.S. deems radical.
Oh, yeah.
So that's how you get radical. On the list. Anything radical that's
the U.S. deems.
And just understand that all across Europe, anybody who opposes the European Union, who opposes the open borders, they're all called radical extremists.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So all you have to do is just be politically opposed to open borders and the destruction of your sovereignty in your country, and you're immediately an enemy of the state, an enemy of the globalist state. And that's what really should concern us. You know, we've got here's an article. 9 out of 10 people on the terror watch list who sought guns were approved in 2015, says CNN. Oh, you think that might be a problem? Well, no, actually, the FBI says, no, there's a reason for that. And it was just, the FBI was just overridden by the Department of Justice. They said, we don't want to have the no-fly list be used as a gun ban. The FBI said that. Why would they say that? Well, they said, we're doing an investigation with these people, and we've got them on this list, and we don't want to alert them if we're actually doing an investigation to see if this person is a terrorist. If you they go in and try to buy a gun, as it is right now, we get notified, but we don't block the gun sale right. because we want to do part of our investigation. You're going to tip them off. So the Obama Attorney General, Loretta Lynch, has now overruled the FBI director because he's under her and said, no, we're going to do it. Not gave it, giving no explanation as to
That's why exactly what they did with the underwear bomber. They were notified by his father and other people that this guy was being radicalized. He was given a bomb, incidentally, that didn't work on purpose. And then Under Secretary of State Patrick Kennedy testified before Congress that they did not block his travel visa because they wanted to see who he was working with. And then this incident happens and they go, oh, body scanners. Oh, we just happen to have him here. And here's the former DHS head who happens to run the company that sells body scanners. It's so, amazing. Convenient.
It always happens. They say, we've been watching this guy for a long time. You hear that every time. You heard it in France. You heard it everywhere. This is a known wolf, not a lone wolf, but a known wolf. They do that constantly. But if it was a legitimate investigation, I mean, this is not even what he's saying is besides the Constitution, besides the principles of the Constitution, you don't even have a good pragmatic reason for doing this. Because if we're doing legitimate investigations of people who are terrorists, who are criminals, who are plotting something, we don't want to alert them. So even the people who buy this official government narrative should look at this and say, this doesn't make any sense from a pragmatic standpoint. Well, forget the Constitution. It just doesn't make any good sense from an investigation. But we know it's been used over and over again to allow these episodes to go forward because it fits their political agenda.
Right. And if everyone's asking, well, the FBI knew about this guy, why didn't they do anything the many countless times? Is this why? Because they were wanting to see who he was talking to, where he was going, and then, you know, maybe he just acted a little too quickly for them to stop him.
Well, they pulled him off those lists a couple years ago. Yeah. But they also include dead people on the no-fly list. Maybe Omar is now on the no-fly list.
Now
that he's dead.
Retroactively on the no-fly list.
Because they do that in case people try to use assumed names. So dead people, children, anybody. And then we interviewed back in 2012 Wade Hicks, who was flying around.
One of the first stories I covered.
Yeah, he was flying around, and a 34-year-old Mississippi resident was going to visit his wife, who was a Navy lieutenant stationed in Okinawa. And on his way back, he got he was basically stopped in Hawaii, and he couldn't
get back. He was on his way there.
He was on his way there.
He never got to see her because they detained him in Hawaii. I mean, you get into Hawaii, and they put you on a no-fly list. He flew there on a military plane. And then they transferred the planes, and he's going to the second leg going to Japan. And they come on the plane as it's about to take off and say, you, come with us.
Yeah,
very dramatic. Took him off, said, you're on a no-fly list. You can't. It was like, what's going on? This guy had been vetted by the TSA. He had all kinds of licenses and privileges from them. He had been vetted for firearms and all these other types of things. No explanation given to him. And, of course, they pull you off in Hawaii. You're stuck if you can't fly. I mean, it's like, how am I going to get out of here? Am I going to catch a slow freighter out of here or whatever. But they kept him there for a couple of weeks. He never got to see his wife. Eventually, because it became a big issue, we covered it. The military stepped down and they put him out. But here's the deal. They would never tell him why he was on the list. They would never tell him how he could get off the list or whether he was still on the list.
He was still on it. And we have that video right now, so you can actually hear from his mouth back in 2012, you know, what this guy had to go through. It was from our old studio. This is David Knight, vintage David Knight from 2012. So let's roll that video.
If you're in that type of situation, you have to keep your head screwed on straight. Don't get emotional and just do whatever you know or what you think is the best thing to do. And for me, it was going to the media, going to my friends, because those were really the only people that were going to be able to help me. The government wasn't going to do anything to help me. They were just doing their whole bureaucratic nightmare stuff. So I could have been there 3 months had I not been as proactive as I was trying to get this story out.
That's right. And they still, to this day, have not given you any information as to why you were put on the list or what your current status is, whether you're on the list or whether you're off of the list.
No, they've never, I've asked for it in writing. They've never given me anything in writing to say that I was on the list. They never gave me anything that says I was off the list. And it completely throws everything we know about the Constitution and due process out the window.
Yeah, it's a very dangerous situation, not just for you, but for everybody. Because when the government can secretly accuse somebody of something, you still have no idea what they thought was wrong.
Okay, and see the rest of that when we come. If you want to go to the Alex Jones channel, you can look that up. This is an interesting quote from Lindsey Graham, our favorite senator here.
says, we got a lot of favorite
senators. Who just went to Bilderberg. Like, yeah. Just went to Bilderberg.
That's right, at Bilderberg.
Little confirmed Lindsey sighting Graham. At the airport.
So here's what Lindsey Graham says. He says, the only way you should get off the list is if they no longer believe you're a threat. It should have nothing to do with not being able to prove a crime. Well, nothing to do with not being able to prove a crime. In other words, as he said before, shut up. You don't get a lawyer. And we don't have to prove that you're not doing a crime or however that works. All these double negatives. I'm confused, Lindsey. How does this work?
Yeah.
It's just pure. I mean, this is tyranny. This is something we should all be very concerned about because it's all done in secret.
And this is one of those problems that's not right out in the open. So unless it's affecting you, most people probably won't even care about this no-fly list because they're not being affected by it.
Right.
But it's going to be a no-dry list.
And there'll be a no-work list. They're conflating the no-fly list with the terror watch list. So people that don't really understand the difference between the two are just automatically assuming it means you're a terrorist and not understanding that children are being put on this list.
Mm-hmm. And you're being, sequestered by people like TSA agents who really have no idea what the law is anyway. And could care less. I had them when I was going to Dresden. They were saying, telling me that the reason we have these body scanners for the underwear bomber. I'm like, look, it's all fake, man. It's all fake. It's all theater. I don't know what more to tell you.
Expose that, yeah.
And it's totally ridiculous, but they don't stop.
All right, I'm David Knight. We're going to be right back with Rob Dew and Leanne McAdoo. There is much more to talk about with this. They say, we're not charging with a crime, so you don't get any due process. Yeah, we'll talk about that when we come back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight with Rob Dew and Leanne McAdoo. We've been talking about the watch list. Watch out, because you may be on that list. You wouldn't know if they put you on the list because they do it in secret. You know, remember the Constitution? Remember the Sixth Amendment? It says you will be given the opportunity to confront your accusers. You'll be able to have a public and speedy trial where you'll get a trial by jury. You'll have a right to a defense attorney, so forth and so on. Why did they do that? Well, they did that, as you all know, because there was a star chamber in England where people, they would meet secretly and they would indict people. And
whisked away in the night.
Yeah, exactly. You disappear in the night. So now we are bringing this back. This is the hallmark of tyranny. This is pre-crime. This is Franz Kafka's bureaucracy where you can't get an answer. It's like, wait a minute, you can't do this or that. Well, I'm on a list. What list? How did I get on the list? What am I charged with? How do I get off the list? I don't know. That's the Kafka aspect of it. It is outright tyranny. Mm-hmm. And I think really the roots of this, if we want to know where this is coming from, it goes back to the war on drugs. It goes on to civil asset forfeiture. Because what they're saying to you is that they don't have to give you due process because they're only putting you on a watch list. And then they're using that watch list to give you punishments. They're saying, we haven't convicted you of a crime. We're not accusing you of any crime. We're just putting you on a list.
We haven't put you in jail yet.
Yeah, exactly.
You just can't fly. You can't get a job.
Yeah, you haven't been accused of a crime. And they've used the same legal fiction throughout the war on drugs to say, we're going to take your property. We're not going to charge you with anything. We're just going to take your plane or your house or your car because we think that your plane or your house or your car was possibly tangentially involved in this crime, but we're not going to charge you with anything. And it's not a criminal action. It's a civil action. And we're just going to call it a forfeiture, not a taking. We're not going to say it's a fine, a penalty. It's a forfeiture. You wanted to forfeiture that, right? And it's a civil action. So that means that if you want to clear your, if you want to get your property back, you have to sue them. They're not going to provide you with a lawyer. You will have to provide the capital to sue them. To get your property back that they
have
stolen.
And they have unlimited money, which is your money, to fight that.
That makes me so angry.
And they usually win.
Interestingly enough, we just had a case come up here in the state of Texas, June 10th. We had the Supreme Court here in Texas say, no, illegal searches are okay and can be used for asset forfeiture cases. So an illegal search would throw them out of a criminal conviction, but they could do an illegal search and still take your property like this car. They said, no, I think that it would punish the law enforcement too much. We already punish law enforcement by not letting them get a conviction. This is what the Supreme Court here in Texas said. We're already punishing law enforcement by denying their conviction, so we don't want to punish them by taking away the stuff they're stealing from you. It's like, what about the punishment of the people?
Right.
That's absolutely insane.
We're always last on the list.
Yeah.
Which is why we just saw this article and we talked about, this is something we talked about years ago.
Yeah.
Feds quietly consider reviving EPA's human testing program. This is where they put people in a room and literally turn on diesel engines and run fumes. Yeah, they hook up the tailpipe and they run it right into a room and you sit and breathe it. And they go, we're going to see how you react.
That does mess up your brain.
And what's even worse about that, Rob, was they were selecting and screening for people who already had respiratory issues and heart issues because they wanted to show an effect, a dramatic
collusion
effect.
Is bad.
Yeah, we had Lisa Jackson, who was head of the EPA at the time, had testified before Congress. She said, no, these fine particulate matter levels that we're talking about, we're not just talking about making people sick. We're talking about death. And then they expose people to 70 times that level.
Exactly.
So they can ratchet up the regulations. And so it's like this catch-22. It's like, well, are you lying to us in Congress? Or are you deliberately doing some kind of Joseph Mengele experiment on people?
And if you look at the weather modification laws that they have written, they can do all this as long as it's in a testing phase. So they could test on us all
Definitely.
Day long as long as they say we're just testing.
Yeah,
we're just testing
just
on it.
Just running some tests.
Oh, yeah, what's falling from the sky? Well, it's just a test. You know,
this is a test. If this were a real genocide, you would be dead by
yeah,
now.
Exactly.
But stay tuned for
we're
those results.
We're going to slow kill you because we want your tax money, you slave. So David, wake up out there. Wake up.
That's right. David Knight, Rob Dew, and Leanne McAdoo. And join us tonight for the InfoWars Nightly News.
Jakari Jackson.
7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern. Not Jakari Jackson will be there for them. Yeah.
Yeah.